revealing their new identity. This is the first time it's called Spain. It was never called Spain. So the country Spain, that word Español or Spain did not exist until that moment. Because prior to that moment, there were regions, and every region had its own identity. Aragon, Castilla, León. So every region has its own language and its own identity and its own people. But the construction of what I call the construction of the Spanish project, creating who is Spanish, begins with the conquista and begins, and it's based on the other. I will be, so who's the Spaniard? I will be everything that the others are not. So it's not about who I am, but I am what the others aren't. So who are the others? The two groups that they highlight. And what's interesting is past is not really past, but it's truly present. Because if you look at the process of highlighting the other, and you look at history, I mean, it's just like there's a blueprint, like there's a booklet. Someone wrote a booklet on how to highlight the other, eliminate the other. Like there is a construction. Like the whole concept of Islamophobia and stereotyping is not a contemporary model. This is a historical model. You can pretty much know how to do it to any group at any time. So it's like a blueprint on how to do it. And there's a whole process to it. So first you say the other cannot be trusted. So you create the lack of trust. After you go from lack of trust, then you do fear. I don't feel safe. Safety, you play on safety. And then the other is not really one of us, the betrayal. Their conspiracy with the outside. They're not true citizens. So you remove the citizenship value of people who consider themselves citizens of the land, right? So the whole process, and it takes time. You can't just do it overnight. No. There's, right. You look at the edicts, you look at the laws, you look at how they were issued. It's a systematic, planned, designed way of elimination. You can't go from a loss, like a political loss, to an expulsion. You don't just expel a people. You can't go from this to that, because people will say, no, wait a minute, we want them here, they're our people. You can't do that. But if you create the entire narrative from how they are, the lack of trust, to the fear, to they're not loyal citizens, to the conspiracy with the outside, now you create something that now they're ready to sign anything or to be part of anything that will take to the elimination process. So the creation of the other is definitely is studied, very well orchestrated, designed project. Yeah? Because it doesn't make sense that you had Jews, Muslims, and Christians living in Spain for centuries, side by side in neighborhoods, and even the architecture says it. You know, there's Moriria, Juderia, Cristiandad, you walk around the neighborhoods and you see how they used to live together. And so these are not people that don't know one another. You're not talking about, okay, I don't know who the Jews are, or I don't know who the Christians are, or I don't know who the Muslims are. They had a bunch of like interfaith dialogues, writing books together, working together, intermarriage. I mean, the society was integrated. So how do you go from I know you to I don't know you? How do you go from you're part of me to you're not even a Spanish citizen? How do you go, the process of I don't know if it's dehumanizing or delegitimization of the other. You have to go, you remove the legitimacy of your existence or your belonging. And all of a sudden, you become the other. The other in what sense? You become the one we can't trust, the one we can't have. So I'm dealing with that time period, and I'm trying to trace the timeline. And I decided to focus on what documents tell me. So what's the time period really that I work with? It's called the Spanish Inquisition period. So the Spanish Inquisition begins right before the fall of Granada, and ends with the independence in 1820. The independence of everybody, like everyone who says to their mom, remember I talked colonial? Colonization. We're going to talk about colonization and how everybody's like saying bye-bye to their mom. I don't want Spain, I don't want Portugal, I don't want France, I don't want England, I'm independent. The concept of independence, yeah? So Inquisition ends with independence. So it begins right before. And then there is Inquisition in general, and then there is a Spanish Inquisition in particular. And they're not the same thing. It's two different apparatus. So the Spanish Inquisition is independent Inquisition from the big umbrella Inquisition. So the word Inquisition, this sounds really nice. I mean, I told you I ask a bunch of questions. I'm like, I'm the student who sits in the class and makes all the questions. Okay? So that makes me an inquisitive person. So, you know, inquisitive means you ask questions, you raise your hand, and you think, and you want to find answers. So it's a good word, right? When I say Inquisition, it doesn't sound really bad. However, the way it was done, the business of the Inquisition is to find out if your heart is truly Christian. It's a heart question. So I want to ask you if you have taqwa in your heart. I don't know. Only God knows. I mean, seriously. I mean, you're going to do an interrogation question, 1 hour questionnaire to find out if I have taqwa, if I have God fearing, or I really believe in God, or I have really faith. I mean, can you do a test faith? How Muslim are you, or how Christian are you, or how Jewish are you? Like, how do you test someone's faith? Based on what? So it's all based on exterior stuff. All outside, because you can't dig on the inside. You can't get into my heart. I mean, try to open it up, go in, ask the questions, figure out if I really believe in God or not. And you're never going to get the answer. Even if you put me on torture machines, and even if you decide to burn me in a public plaza, or even if you come and, you know, eradicate everything about who I am, it still does not go into the heart business, right? So you get the Spanish Inquisition trying to get into people's hearts to find out if they are true Christian. Why? Well, the Pope, right before the fall of Granada, the Pope wants to instill the Inquisition in Spain. And the people in Spain say, hold on, you want an Inquisition? Because the Inquisition is a prior concept. It was a European, it was in France, it's other places, right? You want that kind of business in Spain? We will agree on one condition. We are independent. So it took me a while to understand why they wanted to become independent. Yeah? What's the whole point of independence? Well, Inquisition was a wealth transferring business in the name of God, right? So for to do this wealth transfer, and there's a lot of wealth in Al-Andalus, you got to keep the money in the house. We're not sending the money back to Rome. We're not going to give you the Al-Andalus Muslim Jewish wealth. Hey, take it and ship it back to Rome. We're going to actually keep it right in the house. And if you don't agree, we're not going to do it. So, of course, the Pope agreed. You know, just do it. We're cleansing Europe from Muslim presence, Muslim Jewish presence. But really, it was the big impulse. There was Jewish persecution. If you look at the history, it's really interesting. Mashallah, alhamdulillah. So if you look at the history of the Jews in Spain, the Jews were there before Muslims arrived, and the Jews were there before Christianity was even big. Like they're moving into what they call the Sephard, or land of Sephard. It's a very ancient process. They were very much a part of the Spanish-Portuguese fabric, right? But they went through series of persecutions over and over and over again. They learned how to hide their books. So that this whole business of hiding books and hiding scrolls and all that, this is very much part of the Jewish history, right? And with the Muslims arriving, the opening up the space for the other to exist, for the Jews to be part of, was a brand new concept for Jews. So there was like, that's why they considered it the golden era for Jewish history, right? They produced scholars and knowledge, and they were part of integrated into politics, into science, they were part of everything. We're not excluded from either government or politics or public arena or anything, which was very unique. And they contributed a lot. They were part of the very rich history when it comes to that. Interestingly enough, they were Arabized. So the Jews were Arabized, just like the Christians were Arabized. Means they spoke Arabic. So the Jews were using Allah. Not just Allah, they used the names of Allah. So when you walk into the Jewish temples, in Toledo, for example, I hope you come and join me in my trip to Spain, where I teach and explain the history live. When you're walking in Toledo and you're reading Arabic inside the Jewish temples, you know, As-Salam, Al-Karim, the names of God in Arabic and in Hebrew, side by side. So you got Hebrew and you got Arabic, because they were Arabized, yeah? So you're talking about this exchange of culture, and then when you, and not just exchange of language, architecture, the concept that God in Judaism cannot be physically represented, and you want a space to worship God where you feel a spiritual connection, same architectural designs from mosques were transferred to temples. So the synagogues established in Spain, the flavor of the synagogue is a very Islamic flavor. You walk into a synagogue, you feel like you're in a mosque. With the built in a direction of Jerusalem. So here's the direction of Mecca. This was in the direction of Jerusalem. So it's very same concept, same people discussing, talking, exchanging, doing the same. So there was mutual respect. There was respect. You can't produce this kind of thing without having respect between communities living together. Okay, now I'm going to take you. The PowerPoint is in Spanish for people to follow, and then I will just fill in English. Did I just go down this way, Jenny? How do I do?
Do you know how to make it bigger?
Yeah.
No, see.
So we're now into we discussed several things. We discussed how we create the other. We discussed how these people live together, and then how there was a process of an inquisition instilled to undo all of this, to undo the dialogue, to undo, you know. So basically, it parts from one element, which is fear generating. Fear is very powerful, you guys. Fear. Create fear, you can get anything done. You can get a lot of things done when you do fear. Oh my gosh. Okay, so we're decolonizing history. Last night I was presenting how history is given to us from white Christian male perspective. Whether we like it or not. It's not a female perspective. There's no color perspective. There is no other faith perspective. It's Christian white man, period. So when we decolonize that, that's the colonial project. Anywhere, take that colonial project and apply it anywhere, it works. But now when you decolonize that, means you try to look at the colonized and you write that part of that journey. Interestingly enough, here, this painting that was done in 1800s to describe what happens in 1400s. So there's no connection between the times of the painting. Who painted? The person who painted this is an imaginary view of what happened. Yeah? I will tell you what history is or should be or how you see it. And I'm going to get into the intention of the painter. I'm going to dig inside his mind. I'm going to tell you what the painter wants you to take out of what happened. In this encounter between Christians and Muslims, right? So the painter wants to show you many things. Number one, he's going to show you that Christians weigh a lot more than Muslims. So the first, just visual image, big in number, very few. The other thing is those Christians are on the right, they're the righteous, evil on the left. I'm just explaining to you what you get to see, yeah? Then you have prosperity in green over here, dry, arid on this side. So this side is dry, there's nothing to it. Over side here is prosperity and wealth and future, hope. Then this is really elegant and beautifully dressed. This side looks just poor.
Poor.
Yeah? Then you get a white horse and you get a black horse. Black, evil. Yeah? Not just horse, people. So you have, this is the horse and he's a white man. You got a black person over here submitting with his head, even the action. Yes, sir, Yeah? The submission. Yeah? Look who's submitting to who. Then you get a line, an imaginary line to divide the future from the past. Yeah? And you have this motion feeling that these guys are moving in. This is the... And then the people here are like standing in the back. They're just like, history is just gone. It's over. Don't you even think about it. This is what's really real, right? And you got the crown. There's no crown here. Well, this is a prince too. I mean, where's the crown? There's no crown. Crown, queen, king, religion, symbolism. You got the cross standing up high. And you got the moon at the bottom, right? Top, bottom. I don't know if you can see the horse. Yeah, everything in the painting is symbolism.
And the bright colors too that are on the right, they're very bright.
The bright colors and the dark, spooky. Yeah, you got spooky dark colors on this side, yeah? So what is this? I'm just showing you and then I'm gonna explain to you what is it. So we have, this is Isabel, Fernando, Cisneros, her confessor. She's the queen of Castilla. He's the king of Aragon. They get married, unite the whole Spain, and do the Spain project. They construct an identity and construct a people. But they're taking on, supposedly there's a key, and he's submitting the key. Here, I you know what, here's my key to my house. I don't want my house anymore. Congrats, you can have it, enjoy it, and I'm out of here. All right, so please just take my house and, you know, God bless you, you know what I mean? That's the image that you're getting from this painting. Yeah, here's the key. Please take it and God bless you. You know what I mean? And have a good time in my house while you're at it. You know, like truly it's my palace. And the house is not a regular house. The house is the Alhambra Palace. It's the most visited place in Europe. It's not just a regular house. I'm not just gonna give you, you know, the keys to my ranch or the keys to my, you know, vacation house. This is the house. Okay, so I'm not just giving you any house. I'm going to give you the palace. And, you know, congrats. You know, please enjoy it. So this is the conquered side. And of course, you get the conqueror on this side telling you the story. The name of the land prior to is Al-Andalus. So anybody is from Al-Andalus is Andalusi. That's the identity. That's the, if you want a passport, let's talk about passports, you know. What's your passport? Where are you from? I'm Andalusi. Where are you from? Everybody knew what Andalusi was, right? Andalusi is some. So Andalusi is not a religious term. Andalusi could be a Christian, you could be a Jew, you could be a Muslim. This is not a religious term. So I could be a Jewish Andalusi because I come from Al-Andalus. Everybody knew what that was. So Andalus or Al-Andalus is not a religious term. Has no connotation of religion. As a matter of fact, it's not an Arabic word. The Muslims, when they arrived, they found a tribe called Vandalus. They called the land Vandalus Al-Andalus. So it's named after a tribe that lived there. So actually it's an indigenous term. But it became Arabized with Al. So you put Al-Andalus and you Arabize the term. So it's not even Arabic. Yeah? But it doesn't fit the profile of the construction of Spain. So let's see what it was replaced with. It was replaced with España. España, no? So what is España? What is that word? Well, that word is, it means in Latin, land of rabbits. Land of rabbits. It doesn't mean anything, right? Rabbits? Okay, rabbits. Conejos, tierra de conejos. All right, tierra de conejos. What does that mean? Well, I found documents in the late 1500s where the priests are talking about how Muslims reproduce like rabbits. Oh, no. They have too many kids. They reproduce like rabbits and they do not have the celibacy business. There's no monks, priests, nuns, none of the above. So there is a huge problem with the population of Spain because they reproduce like rabbits. Well, the very same land of rabbits.
I don't know
if I'm
insulted or not.
I don't know. I really don't know. I mean, I was sitting in the archive saying, whoa. All right. So I decided to zoom in on this side. Okay? Because this side has been like, you know when you make it like invisible, like it was a visible side and you try by the same token, it's a Jewish-Muslim side, right? We focus. If you want to look at invisibility of society, the groups that didn't want to be flashy and call for attention were the Muslims and the Jews. Well, then I asked the question that I don't have answer to. I need a team of researchers. Number one, how many are they? According to the painting, they're not too many. They're not too many. So then I started digging. All right, they're not too many. I looked at the records of expulsion. How many were expelled from Spain? There were 300,000 Muslims expelled from Spain. Okay, I don't know if it's a good number or a bad number because I need to know the total number of population to figure out what it represents, right? Well, it represents 3% of the population. So I asked another question. Could it be, and if the expulsion is 900 years, not 800 years, 903 years after, from 711 to 1609, 1614. That's the expulsion time. So then I asked the question, all right. After 900 years, Muslims were only 3% of the population? Okay, let's look at Jewish records. Jewish records say they were between 10 and 15% of the population. So the Muslims, after all of this time, all that time, were only 3% of the population?
Yes.
And they reproduce like, I mean, it's a schizophrenia. On one hand, they're very minimal and they don't exist. I mean, it was just driving me crazy. I look at the priests who complain about how they reproduce like rabbits, same priests, and they're the same ones giving the records on the numbers. They're not, they don't exist, they're not here. I mean, they're very few. So, I read through, and all the books that I check out from the library, all the books, every time, like the titles of all the books, Moriscos, Una Minoría Marginada, a minority. So I already internalized it as a researcher for the longest time that they're a minority, because every book I touch talks about how they're a minority. Minority in the sense of numbers, everything, right? And I said, wait a minute. It does not make sense. Why is it a minority and you're so worried about it and you put a business of inquisition for 354 years to find them? I mean, if they don't exist and they're so little, they're few in number, who cares? And you expel them, so who cares? Who are you searching for? Who are you looking for? These guys are gone, or they died, or they left, or they became Christian, or, you know, their heart is sincere. They embraced Christianity. What's going on? Okay, so I went into, I discovered a politics of labeling and stereotyping. Because they're never called Muslims. Let's just agree on this for life. In Mexico, I'll show you how what they're called. In Spain, Muslims are not Muslims. Never. Ever.
And Moors.
The Moros, then they step down to Morejan, and then they step down to Morisco. So they just take a step down. But even Moro is not even a step up. So we go from bad to worse to the worst. That's how it goes, okay? So like it's kind of like from nigger to I don't know what. But let's, you know, you create the term. I'm actually real about terminology here. And we use it very like easygoing, like it's nothing, right? We really have to understand the meaning. So Moro is a geographic term, means someone who comes from North Africa. And it's a Latin term that the Romans labeled North Africa as such. So the term functions perfectly to delegitimize a people of a land. Because if you're Moro after 800 years, 900 years, 1,000 years, 2,000 years, you're not one of us. From the beginning, you're the North African guy or girl who landed here and then we shipped you back to where you come from. This was never home. So to create the never home business, let's call you the North African immigrant for life. And then the term at some point, Moro becomes Moreno, dark skin. So let's put it into, let's relabel this together. Dark skin person coming in, not European. You're not European. This is Europe. You're not white. Huh? You're not white, right? You're not white, you're moro, or dark skin, right? So that's just moro. And then you have a saint, his name is Santiago Matamoro. So the saint, his like nickname is the killer of moros, means the killer of Muslims. Nobody knows what moros are anyways, so we don't really know who he is. He's a, you know, big hero, Matamoro. I mean, he's just a very nice symbolic, you know? And if you thought moro was Muslim, or moro is synonymous with Muslim, then take Mudéjar. Mudéjar is a Muslim who pays a jizya to the Christian king. He pays a tribute or tax to the Christian king. So he used to be a moro, this North African outsider, who now has to economically become a slave. So in Arabic, mudejjen, min dawejjen, from a chicken or a coward, is mudejjen. So this used to be a North African who pays taxes to the Christian king, and now he's a slave to the economic system, is now the chicken and the coward. And today, that term is used in architecture and in art. So it's arte mudéjar, arquitectura mudéjar. They don't even call it Islamic art. It's the art of the chicken and the coward. So you go to Mexico and you discuss arquitectura mudéjar, and everybody's like, oh, I know exactly what that is. Yeah, exactly what that is. No human representation, you know, based on the tile work, this, that, arches, fountains, da, da, da. Yeah, but they don't call it Islamic art. So there is, if we agree here today, this morning, that there's a whole politics of unnaming. You can't name it, because if you name it, it exists. When you don't name it, it never was here. It was just never here. It doesn't exist. It does not exist. So what do you try to... So it's from the beginning, it's a politics of erasing a memory. I will erase the identity and the memory, and that's how it will construct the entire language. And language is very powerful, because language is how you internalize it. Okay, arte mudéjar, I got you. You know, like, wait a minute. If you are a Spanish citizen or a Mexican citizen or whatever, Spanish-speaking citizen, and you look at Islamic art with your own eyes, and you have no clue that it has anything to do with Islam, zip, your whole life. Yeah, you have no idea it has anything to do with Islam. You just think it's yours. That's colonial. They call it colonial architecture. For God's sake, they call it colonial. Like part of the colonialism project. It's called appropriation of art and work. This is called, let me take what's yours, make it mine, take the credit, you don't exist. And the only thing that Muslim is in all of the terminology is the letter M. So I'm about to publish an article called The Letter M. The Letter M Project, because the only thing Muslim here is the M sound. It's the only thing they captured from the essence of Islam. Moro, moro, mudéjar, morisco. If you thought mudéjar was an insult, morisco is another step down. So morisco is, in the mudéjar time, you pay a jizya, you pay tax to the Christian king to keep your mosque, to get married a la musulmana, to bury a la musulmana, to eat your halal food, and to keep your region, I mean your place of where you live as a group. Well, mudéjar can't do that. You can't pay for freedom of faith anymore. That doesn't exist. You're an ex-Muslim. You're converted by force, and money doesn't buy you freedom of faith. We got your soul. It's a soul business. So now if you thought we got your money with the mudéjar business, we didn't just get your money. We got your money, and now we got your soul. And who's defining this? White Christian people. I mean, who's creating all the terminology? Who's defining? Who's creating this rhetoric, right? So let's reconstruct that world together from this side. So I wanted to look at the identity. I care so much about identity. I care so much. How do you create the identity of the conquistador? Right? So the identity of the Conquistadores built on three things. Number one, there's only one language admitted in this panorama. So the multilingual Iberian Peninsula, Gallego, Asturiano, Catalan, Vasco, all these languages don't matter. There's only one language that counts, the language of Castilla, of Isabel. That's it. She wins. So that woman wins on a linguistic hand. She imposes the Castellano, which becomes synonymous to Spanish, and it's the language of the conquista. Why we are not here in Latin America speaking Catalan, or why we don't speak Leonés, or why we don't speak Euskera or Gallego? They're all languages of Spain. Mm-hmm. Why Castellano? Because it's the language of Castilla. So that moment, this is the era of estandarización del español. So Castellano becomes la lengua estándar. Standard language. That's the official language, the standard language, the Christian language, the evangelization language, this entire project. Are you with me on the project?
Yes.
It's a project. Okay, so now we got, and they got the model from Muslims. Let me tell you why this is a beautiful model. If you look at the expansion of Islam from Medina to Spain, to East and West, the Muslim model is built on two things, language faith. It's a language faith model. How? Language is Arabic, you Arabize everybody, and then there's Islamization that comes after you understand the Quran, and you understand the book, then you read it, and there is people who convert, right? So Arabization, Islamization are not the same thing. You could be Arabized and not Islamized. Are you with me? Yeah. So you got two processes. So that model became the Spanish model. Appropriation even of the Muslim model of conquest. And it functions beautifully. I mean, super successful. So language, Castellano, faith, Catolicismo. So the entire conquista is based on this. Let's evangelize everybody and delete their languages and their history. None of the languages are admitted as anything. Nahuatl, Zapoteca, Azteca, Quechua, all the languages met on the path are languages to be destroyed. You go in with a mode of, I'm going to walk in and delete. Yeah? So now let me tell you. Oh, is it Eurocentric? Is this kind of story a Euro, you know, kind of, yes, very much so. Yeah, are you with me?
Yes.
Okay, let's keep on going. Now let's talk about method of conquest. There's a style. There's a method. So I call this the Spanish project. Yeah? El proyecto España, like the creation of a project, right? So the project is based, are you with me? One faith? So no more convivencia, for people who love convivencia. There's no more Christian, Jewish, Muslims living side by side. The business of convivencia is past tense, okay? Number two, one language admitted. Official language, one language accepted, Castellano. Number three, one race. There's only one race admitted. Let me ask you this question. Which race?
La
raza. La raza. Which race? I mean, this is a really cute question. Which race is the race? There's something called limpieza de sangre.
Sí.
So you gotta buy a certificate from the church that for three generations you have no Muslim or Jewish blood in you. So you got the money, you're clean. No money, you're not clean. So what is this? Wealth transfer business. Limpieza de sangre. I could be clean if I want to. I just have to show some good money on the table and we're good to go. We're good to go. I got mi certificado de limpieza de sangre and see you later, guys. You know what I mean? I mean, that's how it works. So who had the money to pay in that economic system? Who has the doctors, the engineers? Who has the writers, the philosophers, the astronomers? Who has? The Muslims and the Jews. So who in this system can buy the certificate, has the money. Precisely the Muslims and the Jews. If you thought this was money transfer, this is nothing. You haven't seen anything yet. Okay, so then you create a label because it's part of your project. Yeah, part of the project is if you used to be, if you were forced to convert in 1492 as a Jew, then you're converso. That's a converso, like a convert. That's not a bad word. It gets worse. Could be marrano, a pig. So marrano is a pig, right? So you call the Jews pigs because they don't eat pork. So just insult them. You don't eat pork? Hey, I'll call you a pig. That's nice. Okay? I ask the question, what did Muslims create as labels for anyone? For anyone. I mean, I look at Muslim Islamic documents, right? I'm trying to figure out what labels they create. I mean, look at me. I'm looking at this, these documents, and I read Muslim side, and I'm fuming. I'm boiling, right? I want to find them name-calling like there's no tomorrow. Like, I'm going to read this document from beginning to end, and I want them to insult these guys from head to toe. Like, I'm ready. My eyes are ready for this. I go through the entire document, and nothing. Oh my God, what is this? You guys are too nice. You can't be so, I mean, I'm angry for you. You know what I mean? I'm upset for you. How could you not? These guys, what are their like preoccupation with life? Good deeds, doing charity work, consolidating their faith with God, making sure this monotheism business is solid. Remembering some important times in history where difficult times were in, such as persecution in Mecca time, or remembering certain prophets. They really valued certain prophets, such as Prophet Yusuf. Prophet Yusuf became like the hero of this time period. His story was a shared story between Jews and Muslims, and they exchanged talks on Yusuf alayhi salam all the time. Why? Because he went to jail, suffered, but at the end, he prevailed. So that entire inspirational talk from bad times don't mean nothing because you will prevail in the end was really instilled from the Prophet Yusuf story. Are you with me? So the creation of the titles or the creation of those labels was by design because there is an elimination process coming down the road. Yeah? So then, I want to show you a timeline so you can visualize with me intensity of how long this presence was. So 7-Eleven, like the store 7-Eleven, you guys know that story? 7-Eleven? You'll never forget. 7-Eleven is the year Muslims arrived in Spain. Never forget that date, okay? And then, according to Christian side, they vacationed for 781 years, the vacation time. It was just a vacation. They were just, you know, the North African guys, just same people from 7-Eleven were the same people in 1492, yeah? Same people vacation, and then the same people from 7-Eleven, same people. I mean, it's just nothing happened to them over the centuries. It was just same people. Same people. Those extra, those outsiders, the North African outsiders, were expelled between 1609 and 1614, right? And people buy into this. I mean, this looks like I'm simplifying it, I'm making it like sarcastically joking about this, but this is really true. People really believe that there's, you know, they came, left some buildings, and walked away.
We believe you now. We believe you.
So then we have another 122 years of history added to the Islamic history because they were not expelled yet. Yeah?
Correct.
So really, Islamic history, this is, again, from Christian documents, from outside politics. This is not even digging in the underground in the secret documents. This is all from the outside the world. 7-Eleven to 1614 is the history of Muslims in Spain, which is not 781. We're actually now talking about 903 years. It's almost 1,000 years. I mean, I'm rounding up. They're rounding down. I'm rounding up, right? So 903 years of Peninsular Islam. Yes.
903 Islam Peninsular is Spain and Portugal?
Yes, Portugal. Spain and Portugal.
The whole peninsula.
The whole Iberian Peninsula.
Okay, thank
you. Yes, whole Iberian Peninsula. Portugal was separated from Spain, has a different track, but then Portugal also has a later Inquisition, and Portugal focused on the Jews, because the Jews that were expelled in 1492, there was no Inquisition in Portugal, so they just moved west. So it was just easy, and then they went to find them. Hey, bring the money back. I mean, just come here. We're not going to let you go. You know? That's why there's a lot of a Jewish presence in Brazil, from the expulsion of Jews from Portugal, leaving. But then there's a different story of Inquisition. Mm-hmm. So the Spanish Inquisition was just in Spain, and then there was a Portuguese chapter to it. Now let me tell you, let me go back here. Well, if you look at the 122 years, look again. At the beginning of that time period is when Spain is arriving in Mexico or in the new land. So right over here, 1501, forced conversion of Muslims. 1520, the conquistadores are in the new land. Muslims are still in Spain, or leaving, or not leaving. We don't know what happened. The same time period, we know they expelled them this time. Yeah? Mm-hmm. Well, the Inquisition ends in 1820. The Spanish Inquisition ends 1820, and it begins right here, early 1400s, so 354 years of Inquisition. Inquisition begins in Spain, but transfers to Mexico. So I found three centers of Inquisition in the New World. New World means what they call New World, right? Las Americas. So what did I find here? Let me show you. So the three centers of the Inquisition are Mexico City, Cartagena, Colombia, and Lima, Peru. These are the three centers of Inquisition. So let me ask you a question. Okay, they are in the process of evangelizing natives. Okay, they got to, this is a whole old history. Jews and Muslims is a finished business, it's done, deal. They get to the new land, their business is the colonization project. And now we got the indigenous population and we're gonna go after them. That's it, you gotta become a good Christian because we are here for this business and we're here to teach you Spanish and this is the colonial project and you're gonna sign up. Surprise, surprise. Los indígenas son exentos de la Inquisición. Indigenous population is exempt from Inquisition. Who are you looking for? I mean, wait a minute. You're not after, you're here in the business of evangelizing the people. Which people? Like, who are you evangelizing if you didn't come after the very same people that you told everybody in Spain, hey, we're going to go and get the natives, and we're going to evangelize them, and we're going to teach them Spanish, and you know, we're in the business of God, and we're spreading the word of God, and this is what we're doing. I mean, wait a minute. Why don't you go after the very same people that you say are supposed to be embracing the word of God? No. They don't believe in property and ownership of land. They don't have land, hacienda, pachamama, and patria. I mean, they don't have the concept of land ownership and that's got and gold and silver and all that stuff. I mean, they were gold and silver is another term. The gold of Lima, you'll find it in Madrid, you know, on the altars. You'll find it in, like the entire Lima, just, you know, the gold transfer. I mean, the same colonial project. This is really interesting. Same people, same white Christian guys, same people, I don't know. I think it's the same people from the beginning to end. Just like they think we are the same people from beginning to end. Very interesting. But anyways, so this three centers of Inquisition, I didn't know until last week, actually. Didn't know until last week that I found the most important center, the one I studied in Mexico City, is the most important one. Because I went to talk to a professor in the University of Colegio de Mexico, who's a specialist on Inquisition, and he told me the story of these two archives. So these two archives, because I told him I want to go down and continue the research, you know, Cartagena all the way to Lima. I really want to see it. And then he said, I have news for you. Those were burned by the priests. I don't know how much you're going to find, but the best one we have intact is the one here in Mexico City. So focus your research here to get to what you want to get, because the ones down there were burned. Well, what are you really burning? Evidence of crime. Against who? Against the very same people that you're going after. Yeah? So if the indigenous population, I'm still in awe about this, are not part of the Inquisition, because they're supposed to be the ones with the faith, the wishy-washy faith. I mean, aren't you in the heart business? I'm looking for the wishy-washy people who are not really the good Christians, yeah? Should be them. I mean, they're the newcomers, the brand new converts to Catholicism, whether they like it or not. The ones who have to walk into the same temple from the Aztecs or Mayans, or, you know, same temples from yesterday, and we put the catedral on top, and you go in and you worship this God, and you gotta do what I tell you to do, and speak a language you don't understand, and go at it. I mean, and then wait, and the mass is in Latin. Nobody speaks Latin, but I'm teaching you Spanish. So you're learning Spanish, you don't understand anything in mass, and you're indigenous, and you're in your own country, and you're being colonized. And they're still colonized, by the way. Latin America has not left, colonialism is right there, hasn't left ever. That's the problem with Latin America, actually, is they're still in the process, they need to decolonize up here. They need to decolonize. Okay, so then Al-Andalus then, from beginning to end, you know, going up and then going down, 400 years up and down, in the Muslim imaginary, or in the Muslim side of it, there's only this time that is interesting for us, like this time. It's going down, business is not interesting, or the what happened after, it's also completely. So quickly, 16th century, and I want you to draw parallel for everything I will say. This is Muslim Jews, indigenous population, and slaves. There's four genocides happening 16th century. Four eradications, parallel, happening at the same time, different places, by the same colonial minds, the same people. So, you forcefully convert. Ready? Muslims, Jews, Christians, Muslims, Jews, indigenous population, and slaves. Yeah? You give them new names, you erase their past, you erase their lineage. New names, no past, no lineage, your bloodline is destroyed, and you get a new religion. That's step one. Step two, you create a label. You'll always be labeled. Indigenous, you'll always be indigenous. A slave, you'll always be a slave. I mean, you don't lose your label. You are stereotyped. It's not like because, okay, here I am, I converted, mashallah, but now it's upward mobility for me. Like, I am you now. Although you're not me, you're the other. I mean, you're still the other. I mean, your category hasn't really changed much, but you forcefully convert and you get the new name. But wait, I'm you now. Like, I'm exactly like you. What's the difference? I mean, we worship now the same God. Are we the same people? No, we're not the same people. The blacks are not allowed in the same church. You got your own church. Not part of us. You got your own church. Yeah, you've been Christianized, congrats, but no, you don't mix. Yeah? Yeah? I mean, yes, congrats for joining the team, but you really don't join the team. I mean, it's a selective joining. Because there's racial... I mean, you're still not the white Christian man. I mean, you're still not there. Not there yet. You'll always be inferior. You'll always feel less than. Indigenous, less than, look at indigenous population from Mexico south. I mean, just look. Okay, so you first convert, supposedly you did a jump up, but you really stayed behind. But that's okay, that's step one. This is just number one. Number two, your very same place of worship from yesterday becomes the new place of worship. Superimposition of a cathedral on top of a temple, or a church on top of a mosque. So I will just transform the place of worship. Why? To remind you forever that you lost. I want you to remember it for life. you and the generations to come and forever. Because it's easy to destroy you and build me. I'm the colonizer. I'm the colonizer here, right? So I want to delete the past, right? The best way to delete the past is to completely destroy the mosque and put a church and it's gone. Business. You don't have to remember anything. No. I need you to remember this. Don't you ever think of bringing it back. Yeah? So what's yours is mine. And what's mine is not yours. Yes.
It's like a psychologically, emotionally, like, impact, right? Because, yes. I mean, when I was over there in Cordoba, you can see even the contrast in the Great Mosque of Cordoba, which is not named Great Mosque of Cordoba anymore. And then on the other side, it's like a Gothic. But then if you go inside, it looks like a mosque, smells like a mosque, all the trees and everything, but yet they put the status. It's like a one day you're fine, you can make sujood, but the other day is like, boom, you have the all this status. It's like the pain for the people that were living there is like...
The point was the pain. You gotta feel the pain. You have to. Daily reminder of your loss. Do you remember the painting of the loss? The keys? Do you remember the keys? I gave you the keys to my house. Here, you got my house, please enjoy, have a good time, and it's a palace, and you have a view, and, you know, very expensive property, and it's gorgeous, but please enjoy it. A reminder of that loss on a daily basis.
Alhamdulillah, that's why these arcs are right there. You see the similar arcs? It's a reminder of a claim of a heritage that is not really well known, right, and going back to those roots that were good for a people, right? And that's part of our history that we, lost because of that very incident, trying to erase it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But it wasn't just a baby child. I mean, it was a project. I want you to internalize that it was a mega project. Yes, and it's still ongoing, by the way. I mean, yes.
Since you traveled to Mexico, you're probably very much aware of the La Villa, how La Villa was also constructed on top of the temples in Mexico City, which is now the place of pilgrimage for Catholics in Mexico and Latin America. La Villita, you probably know that.
Like Guadalupe?
La Villa de Guadalupe is is pretty much the Mecca of Latin America. And people, Catholics, go there for pilgrimage and do stuff and ask for miracles. We went there ourselves. And it is on top of what used to be also temple. And if you go to Cholula and Puebla, you also see the big cathedral on top of the big pyramids, which were also temples of worship for the people that were there. And it is true. It is a reminder of saying, we are on top no matter what. And you get to see the pyramid, but it is on top. So this is very evident.
No vamos lejos, la capital de México está ahí, la catedral de México está sobre las pirámides.
And I see with the basilica in Mexico City, where they have the glass where you can see the old Azteca temples. It's under where the church is on top. Y'all are under the ground now. You're buried.
Yeah, it's so evident. It's amazing.
Almost all the churches they are built in Mexico, they are under the other pyramid. They are on top on the pyramid.
Do you see it?
Yeah.
We talked about four groups. Yeah. Talked about four groups, and it's parallel histories. Yes. Anyone?
They say that part of the reason why the Catholic Church did that was to make it easier for the converts to accept their new religion. That they incorporated religious holidays.
It's a beautiful way of justifying the crime against the people. Yeah, of course. It's the to make it easier to convert. Yeah. Yeah, right.
Kind of dual purpose. It's got we'll accommodate you, but at the same time, don't forget, we conquered you. So now your holidays are now our holidays.
Appropriation.
Appropriation.
It's appropriation. It's exactly like the Islamic art that's called colonial art.
Mm-hmm.
What's yours is mine. What's yours is mine. Okay, keep going. So, without the conversion of places of worship, we're on number two, step two. Huh? So, very interesting. The first mosque built in Spain is in the year they arrived. Do you guys remember the year?
711.
Okay, so 718 is the first mosque and it's built in Zaragoza. Zaragoza produced a lot of scholars. It was the center of scholars. Everybody thinks it's Cordoba. Cordoba is the hub of knowledge. Well, Zaragoza is huge. And the documents I found were Zaragoza documents. written way back. I mean, way late in the game. Like, this is not an early phenomenon. This is a much later phenomenon. So early mosque with a lot of scholars in Aragon. Aragon is like today's near Barcelona. So this is north. This is a northern phenomenon. Not a southern business. Everybody thinks it's... I want to also remove that myth that Islam is Cordoba, Sevilla, Granada, and south. No. Islam went the entire peninsula.
All the Pyrenees.
Oh, wait. Yeah. So Islam was not... It's not a southern phenomenon. For 2 years, I was answering the question why my documents are a northern phenomenon. Because I wanted a document from Cordoba, Granada, Sevilla, something that's the south that would represent what I think I know about that history. But the document forces me to think outside the box. Not what you think. Let me tell you what really happened. What really happened is the entire peninsula was Islamized. So Islam is not, yes, Cordoba was the capital of the caliphate, but that doesn't mean that Muslims only lived in Cordoba or around Cordoba. Yes, Granada is the last Muslim state to collapse, but that doesn't mean Muslims are only in Granada. But it's really nice to paint it this way. So you can, until today, the people in Toledo and Madrid and all the, by the way, Madrid is Arabic word. You have a country, this is the irony of life. You got a Spain that has a capital that's in Arabic. Madrid, no? Arabic word. And then the guitar, the symbol of the Spanish symbol, the Muslims brought it in, right? It's an acoustic guitar. Then you got a dance, a flamenco, that also has an influence from Muslims, right? So, and then you got a paella, that's Española, which is the main dish, which is an Arabic term. So, you built yourself upon the very same people.
You conquered.
You conquered.
That's how conquest works.
Mm-hmm. And then you call yourself Spanish, white, Christian, blah, 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 rabbits, yeah. Anyways, let's keep going. I just want you to think. I'm not giving you answers, actually. I just want you, this is the process of, I want you to think with me. Because I don't think I even have answers. I'm still digging. I'm still looking. All right? So this is the, look at this. This is the mosque church, right? I mean, look at this. The feeling, no? It feels like a mosque, right? Okay, in architecture, Mezquita Iglesia. By the way, I want to show you this. This mosque church, this area here, is a perfect square, exact same size as the Kaaba. You're in it, you're in the Kaaba. Exact dimensions, width, height, everything. This mosque right here. Over here, it's the place where the acoustics for the prayer, like the imam and lining up. But this right here, and the entrance to the mosque, so they have a legend around this. Take the legend. The Christian king, that's why it's called El Cristo de la Luz. Oh, let's see why.
What's that mean?
A Christ of the light, like the light, okay? So the Christian king is going up to conquer the city from the Muslims. And his horse kneels in front of this construction. Yeah. And then he sees light shining up, and that's why they call this place Cristo de la Luz.
Take the legend.
Kneeling horse. The horse couldn't keep on going, he knelt, he went down on his knees.
Like the elephant of Allah.
Yeah. So now let's look at number three. And then this is again, remember I talked about parallel history? You destroy texts and books. So for someone like myself who is in the business of finding books, after the books have been destroyed, I'm actually working with what they call a leftover. I'm in the leftover business, the paella. I'm in the paella business, okay? Because I work with whatever is left, because the books are destroyed. You don't want anybody to know, right? You don't want anyone to know what really happened. So what is now present is what survived the destruction. That's why it's very relevant and significant what I do. I mean, I consider it to be like a religious obligation to dig, keep on digging. Yeah? SubhanAllah, I have to. I can't stop. It's like I'm addicted to this. And the more I find, the more I find. It's like it's crazy. But anyway, so you're with me here? Number one, anybody? I want to see if you guys are awake or you need coffee or what's going on. Number one was? Oh no. Oh no, Dallas. Yesterday you said Dallas. I took this line from you. Hey, Dallas. Are you with me? What happened? Number one?
En crear el innombrado.
Yeah, so number one was?
The
conversion, the new name, and the destroying of lineage. Number two?
Language.
Number two?
Appropriation
of your place of worship. Yes, you got it? Yes, your mosque? Number three? Burning of the books. Are you with me? Because we're going to keep going. Huh? Number five? Number four, sorry. Destruction of public bath. So, if your whole Islam is built upon cleansiness and wudu and ghusl and cleansiness and all that business for you to pray and have a mosque and feel good about yourself and smell good and, you know, clip your nails and cut your hair and look good and smell good business, if that's your what you value, we're going after it. Guess what? You smell good? Yes. Why? Are you Muslim?
Are you washing? Yeah.
Are you Muslim? Mm. You gotta stink if you're a Christian.
Yep.
That's why we need perfume. So you can cover up your smell.
Yep.
Louis the 14th, the in France, Louis 14, no? Built Versailles, the palace of Versailles. He took seven showers in his life. He lived 76 years, took seven showers in his life. So every 10 years, they used to believe in Europe. I'm going to talk here about white Christian man. Right? White Christian male perspective. Bathing is dangerous to your life. You can lose your life, can die, water's bad. In the Muslim world, you wash your hands, you wash your feet, you wash your nose, you wash your eyes, you wash your this, you wash that. You only want you live around the washer. I mean, think about when you go by a home as a Muslim, the Muslim friend, how many bathrooms are there? I mean, you know, you care. I mean, yeah? You don't even think about it, but it's just an auto thing, right? You put a washer, you clean, where's the thing, and attach the thing to the toilet. I mean, think about all the things that as a Muslim, how Muslim are you? Test, you know? Let me go inside. What is this thing in your toilet there? What is this? Oh, you guys are clean. Oh, wow, you clean. Oh, wow. You know, what is this, right? Think about the French bathrooms today where the toilet and the sink are not in the same spot because you can't have water access inside the bathroom. The salle de bain et toilette. I mean, there's two different things. So you go to the toilet and then you wash your hands and they're two different rooms. And they're two different rooms in architecture, right? This is the French design, right? And then here you have Al-Andalus. People have a spa, nail clipping, do their hair, smell good, dress good, look nice, have fashion, styling, architecture. These guys are like having a good life. These guys are living a good life. Oh my God. So in Mexico, what I was looking for, people who are wearing camisa blanca or camisa limpia. Because if you're wearing a clean shirt on a Friday, guess who you are? Guess who you are? You better be a Muslim. Why are you wearing a clean shirt? Where are you clean? Where's the mancha? I mean, show me some stains here, you know? If you wash your clothes, where are you washing clothes? Are you clean? Wait, are you a Muslim? Hey, hold on. Let me sniff you around. I mean, why do you smell like this? You take a shower? Why do you think you need to take a shower? Who are you? Who do you think you are? Oh, yeah, anyhow. Coming from the heart, you know what I mean? I have to know, I don't live this. How to, you know, as a Muslim, like, really, if you want to torture me as a person, torture like this. I don't need the Inquisition. Just take a water access away from my life. If I can't shower for like a day, I'm like suffering. You know, like, oh my God, I stink. I gotta take a shower. You know, I don't know, but this is how Muslim are you, you know? Right?
Yes.
You just can't handle it. You need to be clean. Yes.
I read a piece of information
mentioned to add on to this, that they used to make weddings in the summer because all winter long people are just wearing clothes, and the bride would carry a bouquet to cover up the smell that she has.
Mm. That's true. That's true.
That's what I read. Yes. And so
the tradition of the foul bouquet is to cover up your smell?
The bride's smell.
Yeah, because you have not bathed.
You
because
bathe
it was cold.
That's why France is very famous for perfume.
Yes.
Y también por las pelucas. Por eso se inventaron las pelucas, porque no se bañaban. En toda su vida no se bañaban. Entonces tenían piojos. Les caía cuando estaban comiendo los piojos, les caían, por eso usaban las pelucas tan altas. Era gente muy sucia, no usaban. Imagínense, y luego para hacer el baño también, cómo iban al baño y no se lavaban.
She's talking about the wigs and how they were like the tradition of lice.
Yeah,
I want to go there. Of how they didn't wash their hair or something. But anyway, then there's yes.
Yeah. En México son muy famosos los baños de Nezahualcóyotl. Quiere decir que todos los aztecas y los se bañaban. Nezahualcóyotl se bañaba 3 veces al día. No sé si visitó ahí en México los baños de Nezahualcóyotl. Sí.
Aguas
no
termales.
Son los baños. Sí. Y él tenía los baños en una montañita, y desde ahí él, mientras estaba bañando, visualizaba todos los jardines que tenía, porque eran los jardines regados, era un lugar precioso. Ahora que vaya a México, a ver si también se documenta con eso. También éramos y seguimos siendo limpios los mexicanos.
La mayoría.
No, but the whole concept of cleanliness and hygiene, personal hygiene, all that stuff. I think Latin America is much more in the hygiene higher end than Spain and Europe. There's a huge difference in hygiene between Latin America and Europe. Yeah. This is where I don't think the colonial project didn't really get the successful, because, you know, I wasn't sure if it's because they're closer to beaches or the warmer weather, the heat, something, but they couldn't control the showering business like they did in Spain. Spain, there was a destruction of public bath, systematic. Like in a place like Cordoba, there is like Cordoba that had like 900 public baths. Today there's a surviving like what, 10 from 900? And the 10 were discovered in homes, the people hid them. Yeah, so yeah, they were in every corner, basically. You're gonna go to the masjid, you stop there, you get your wudu, you take a shower, you do this, and you step on the masjid and you go pray. It's part of the daily routine. Yeah? Yes?
Well, just to add on the whole Catholic Christianity, the Pope had made many bull edicts in regards to saying that washing regularly was considered a sin. You were only allowed to wash certain days throughout the year, especially during the holy days. But other than that, if you washed excessively, and I'm sure it had something to do with Islam on top of that, because you wanted to differentiate yourself from the quote-unquote infidel, is that you needed to have that mark between both of y'all. So one of the deals is that the Pope had made many papal decrees saying that washing at any time except through certain times throughout the year was haram, completely forbidden.
Well, I'll tell you something. There's an adaptation architecture to this water business. So the adaptation architecture is people started building homes with water fountain in the middle. So if you notice what they called the Spanish architecture, Spanish home, there's open patio and there's water access. There's a well in the home, even in Cordoba today. Well inside the home, every home has a well or a water fountain. And they called it for beauty and aesthetics. So they didn't call it Islam. You're not going to call it, I need water so I can wash. I need water because it sounds good and relaxes. You know, looks good in my home. Adaptation. Also, windows were closed off on the streets. So people, whatever you do in your home, can't be seen. So one of the things that was really, that caused the attention, homes in this time period have no curb appeal. You know how like you make a nice home, you make it look super nice and you can see what's in it? I was very amazed that in Mexico I walk into places, or even Colombia, places that look normal, that you walk in and it's like, wow, that's so nice inside. Why does it look nice on the outside? On the outside it looks like a wall. And then there's a door, you walk in and like, we're going here? yeah, this is where the wedding is. This is where the wedding is? And you walk in, it's like, wow, what happened here? How come on the outside it looks so plain and boring and there's a wall? There's nothing. Adaptation. Don't know what's inside. There's no decoration of windows. But in Lima, Peru, very interesting. I have the windows, the mashrabeya, the work. You know, you can see there's a curb appeal. So some places, they maintain the outside curb appeal, look with the woodwork and the tile and this. And then you have other places where walls and you don't know what's inside and big walls. All you have to see is doors, 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 doors. You just see doors. Yes.
If I'm understanding correctly, are you saying that those are survival strategies that the Muslims...
Yes, survival strategies. Muslim survival, urban planning, construction of zones.
You know, in Colombia, they call these baths, like they call it baños turcos,
baños turcos,
or baños árabes, right? Yeah. So it's Arab baths or Turkish baths, till this day. And even the sauna, you know, they use eucalypt and everything, they call it Turkish bath in Colombia till this day. They don't really, they don't know where it comes from.
Thank you. Yes.
Can we ask more questions, but for reference to earlier?
Yes.
Okay. When you said, talk about the North African and the slaves were coming there, morals, did it have anything to do with the Shakespearean play, Othello the Moor? And when was it written, or could it be that
definitely
it affected both?
Okay, hold on. Shakespeare's era is what? Expulsion time. When is Shakespeare? It's Cervantes. When is Cervantes? Cervantes is 1609, 1614. When is Shakespeare? Same time period.
Yes, this is, he's from England and Cervantes is
it's from Spain.
Spain.
So Cervantes and Shakespeare are contemporary writing at the same time.
They call him a Moor.
Right, the Moor, the Muslim. Also, reference to other one you talked about, the rabbits. Does that have anything to do with the adaptation of Easter and the rabbits and the multiplication and the spring and
I think Easter is the Roman.
Easter is a different.
I'm happy that you're trying to put symbols together.
Connecting things together: destruction, crucifixion, multiplying the rabbits. Something.
But the issue is like they celebrate that actually, it's not like condemning it. So that came from Ashtar, which is Easter right now. You can go back to the history and read about Ashtar, the god of prosperity.
I like because I mean, you can say that they're trying to tie in that Muslims, you know, they're pagan too. You know, trying to, again, distance themselves.
Othering, the process of othering.
Yeah, the process of othering.
Good.
I'm sure there could be some type of correlation. Yeah. That would have to be more research on that. But that's interesting.
Yes,
yeah.
I think one of the best important things is about thinking about the aqueduct. The Muslims are the people who brought the idea of the aqueduct.
Into Latin America.
Yeah, how to translate the water from there, from far places to the different magis, the different.
Well,
and that's it.
Amazing. So he's nailing something important here, which is the importance of water.
Yes.
Yes, water and water access.
Exacto. And it's one of the things we are studying in agriculture, how to do the irrigation to the land, how to do the drains. But the Muslim did the first drain to the bad water. When we are going to the bathroom and we are flushing, that is the bad water.
Sewer.
The Muslim did both. How to
get the
do
clean
the
water.
Aqua to the clean water, how to use the
exactly.
This is the most important thing. I think is the how important is to think about that. No. What country is doing that? But no, from where is the best idea how to use the water? Now in this moment, a lot of universities are coming again, studying the idea about the Muslims. I did one videotape, the history of the science, the Islam in the science. The best golden age in Spain was the 700-800 years when the Muslims did the government in Spain. Así, a lot of things, especially the use in the gardens, the use in the cities. Now in this moment, they are studying everything about you are talking about.
Just for the because she has to leave, she has to take a plane in a little bit, and this presentation, this is basically just the starting. So if we can just please let her go, let her just, and then if you can please, whenever you think there are some questions or some doubts, if you can just open the panel, but let her do the MC. Let her speak, and then inshallah you guys.
I appreciate it.
Because I think the opportunity to talk about the water. The water is one of the important things now in this moment.
She's trying to put up a 3 days conference, 3 days conference, into like 3-4 hours, right?
Yes.
So it's a lot of material.
So then we talked about this, right? We talked about how there was 354 years of searching for how Christian are you kind of investigation, yeah? And then you get the people here, you do, it's called Santo Oficio, it's not really saint or anything, but anyway, it's just for, and then, okay, people were leaving Spain, who was leaving, just some fun, you know, the concept of deportation, all that concept, there's all these historical migration, exodus, refugees. I mean, yesterday we were talking about refugees, I was just thinking about this, you know what I mean? Refugees. So really, the Muslims and Jews were the refugees going into those lands, yeah? If you want to use today's terminology, you know, what's going on here. And then here's the expulsion, the painting of the expulsion. And so who stays behind? The Jews were expelled in 1492 as families. Complete families, father, mother, children. The Muslim expulsion was different. Because Muslim expulsion, women and children were not allowed to leave. So only men have to go. So now the male, the Muslim father, has to say bye to his wife and his kids, his mom, his sister, and say bye to everybody, get on the ship, and find a new life. These are the documents I was talking to you about, yeah? And how they look like. And now, this was my journey in Spain on the documents, but then here's my journey in Mexico. So I asked the question, so it could be a diaspora to this, it could be a continuum of this, could they have gone into these places? And why not to go to Muslim land? Hold on, this is still, the Ottoman Empire was in action at the time, because look at the time period, this is 1492 is when the Turks, this is right after the fall of Constantinople. So we have Istanbul established, we have the Turks in the east, they're gaining momentum, and the Ottoman Empire is growing in size. So why not go and live in the Ottoman Empire? Why not?
Some did,
and some didn't, right? But there's also something to be considered. Muslims from Spain, the Al-Andalusis, were well received in Tunisia, but they were treated very badly in Morocco. So Morocco didn't want them. They were like beggars on the streets. They didn't have a good they didn't have a good life as they did in Al-Andalus. So basically, I want you to think of the Palestinian model. Why not Egypt donate the Sinai to the Palestinians and give them a new land and, you know, make them become Egyptian citizens and embrace them in? Is it happening?
No.
No. Why not? This is what Morocco could have done. Hey, we have an empty piece of land, you guys, you know, I feel so sorry for you, you're going through persecution. Just come over here and live a good life, and we give you land. We are Muslim brothers, and you are ours, and what's happening to you is a disaster. Here is a piece of land, go at it. It's the same question today. So the past is not really past, it's present. Why can't we allow the Syrian refugees into all these countries and applaud and be so happy? Iraqi refugees, Syrian refugees, Palestinians. Why are they resistance in the Arab world to accept them and give them passport? Hey, oh, they don't want you in your country, or there's persecution. Just come over here. Here's a passport for you. Just, you're one of us. You're my brother. Here's my home. I give you half of it. You want money? I give you a teacher. Why not? So the Muslims of Al-Andalus don't have a different story to tell. They weren't really welcome in the Muslim land. And they were looked down upon. Oh, you're the one who lost your land to the Christian kings? You're not, you don't even have a value. Oh, you're the one who was baptized in 1501? You're not even Muslim. So the story of the Muslims in the writing is a story of pain. And within Muslims, I'm Christians. With the Christians, I'm Muslim. I don't know where to fit. I don't fit anywhere. Put me with the Muslims, they label me and consider me Christians because I got baptized and my name was changed. All this stuff happened to me. Now I go with the Christians because I want to live with them, because I can't fit in the Muslim land. I fit in the Christian land, because that's really, I'm in Andalusia. I mean, that's my home. I mean, put me with my home, with my own people. Yeah? But my own people see me as the other. I go to the others, who are supposed to be my, like, brothers in Islam, and they see me as the betrayer, the evil. Like, you don't know what happened to me. I mean, I didn't choose this. This is happening to me because I lost in politics. I'm not responsible for political gain. I'm not responsible if my leader is a coward and he's a betrayer of my people. I am a product. Think of the Syrian refugees, what they say to them. I'm not responsible for the government and what they do to me. I just lost my security and I have to go somewhere. Please embrace me. Talk about refugee stories. Please embrace me. Put me somewhere. I just want to feed my kids. I don't want my wife to be raped. I don't want my girls to be raped. That was the concept in Al-Andalus. I don't want the women raped. I do not want the women raped. That was the cry of the people. Embrace us. So in the Muslim land, coward, you don't protect your land. Look at what you've done to yourself. You're a disgrace to Islam. Look at the Islam you guys did too. Look at what you've done. It's not me, my politicians. I'm the people. Then you go to the Christians. Oh, you're the Moro? Or are you the Morisco? You're the convert? You're not really a good Christian. Hey, let's see the Inquisition. Let's give you a nice check to see if you're good. Where do you go?
The new land.
The new land. It just makes sense. It makes sense. Because within Muslims, I'm not really Muslim. So there was a prohibition of the cross-Atlantic move. Because you can't be a Muslim or Jew from the past and cross to the new world. So people would station in Sevilla, the port, to do the, they call it el cruce transatlántico, no? To do the, and they stayed for a year. There's also something that I have a friend of mine who researched, which is called el español andaluz. The Spanish spoken in the new world is very different than the Castilian Spanish, really, in the pronunciation. Some people say, which one is the better Spanish? Well, I'm a linguist. They're all valid. There's no better or worse. There's no hierarchy, there's no classification. There is Spanish with regional descriptive, you know, it's kind of like saying which Arabic is better. Is the Palestinian Arabic better than Iraqi Arabic? Or is the Saudi Arabic better than the Libyan Arabic? Or the, you know what I mean? They're all Arabic. It's just different regions speaking different dialects. So there's no higher, superior, lower, there's nothing like that. Within linguistic terms. However, until today, somebody from Spain goes to Mexico, like, oh, these guys don't know how to speak Spanish. You know, and then they go to, like, Colombia, and they say, oh, these Colombians don't know how to speak Spanish. Hey, when are you going to learn Spanish? Right? Colonial mentality. So even today, the colonizer, Spanish identity, thinks they're higher or superior because their Spanish is better than someone else's Spanish.
Same thing in the Arab world, for example.
Yeah.
This country believe that they are better than this country.
This country.
What kind of language? Why do you speak? I don't understand you.
Exactly. Yeah. So the whole colonization. Superiority, colonization, same colonial thing. But then how is this related to Islam? Is because the Spanish spoken in Sevilla is the Spanish of America. It's a southern Spanish. Mm. It's not a Castilian accent. There's no theta, there's no none of the above. It's not the Toledano from Toledo or Madrid or the north. It's a southern phenomenon. So if you study the rasgos, the linguistic pronunciation of Spanish in Latin America, it's derived from southern Spain, from the Muslim influence, from the Muslims. So even the language tells you that the way they pronounce it and speak it is the southern Muslim influence on the language, okay? Keep going. So I give you this, and now we're gonna go and see what kind of documents I found, okay? Hold on. I found three groups of documentations in what they call La Nueva España, New Spain, yeah? So the first group of documentation is legal and edicts. Edicts are laws issued to ban Islam. 280 laws issued in 250 years of Inquisition to ban Islam and Muslims in La Nueva España. Well, they say they ban it, but they're not here. That doesn't mean that there's laws that that exist. They're not here. Oh, okay, they're not here. Well, I found Inquisition cases. This is the church. This is the state. This is the church. Well, the church now has documents, casos inquisitoriales, Inquisition cases, court cases. And by the way, Inquisition is a court, like a legal document, no? So court cases in which there's enjuiciado and juez, there's a judge, there's accused, there's somebody who's accusing, there's a victim, there's like a whole court case with testimonies and bring in somebody to testify that yes, he was using camisa blanca, and that's a big problem for, you know, it's a huge problem, you know what I mean? The crimes that you had to endure. And then the third group of documentation is what Muslims wrote by Muslims for Muslims. What you write that the author is a Muslim and the reader and the consumer of the document is a Muslim. Well, I begin my research in Mexico, and I know from my Spanish investigation that they're not called Muslims. So I don't waste my time. I put Muslim, I just do it for a joke. First day I arrive, Muslims, Islam, Arabs, that's a joke. And the search engine says zero, which is expected. I'm not surprised. As a researcher, I know the M has to be something with an M in it or something like that. But to my shock system, the terminology went wild. I mean, really wild. This is the National Archive. And I found that they're called different things. Mm. I found 35 ways of calling Muslims, 35 ways of calling Muslims in colonial Mexico. Just if you thought you were creative, it gets even more creative. So they're called seguidores de la secta de Mahoma, the followers of the sect of Muhammad. They're called Mahometanos, the Mohammedans or Mohammedism or is, you know how they create words for us today like I look at the media and I smile, I don't know if I smile or cry. I mean, I don't know how to react to the media creation of terms that I don't know who is the creative person. Like, for example, Islamist. You know those terms?
The lady asked me about
that.
She said, are you Islam?
No, but Islamist is a man, is a made-up word, right? Islamist, you know, all these terms that I see in contemporary times. I'm a linguist, you know, so I analyze the terms. I'm like, wow, these guys are really going at it. You know what I mean? So, Mahometizantes, Mahomedes, Moros, Tabamudejares, Morisco, Turcos, Otomanos, Saurías. Saurías comes from the word in Arabic, seher, because they found women who were using words in Arabigo, Arabic words, to cure the sick people. Like, you know how you read the Yasin for someone who gets sick? Okay. Well, these are the category in the Inquisition called Saurías, no? Then Ismailitas, the descendants of Ismail. Ismailíes. Then you get Saracenos. Then you got Andaluces. Then you have Elches. Oh, this is the cutest one. Elches and Hijos de Elches. This is wild, okay? Who's an Elche or Hijo de Elche? Who is this category? This is someone who was Christian. By conviction converts to Islam, but then the church brings them back to Christianity. This is the worst category. Why? Because they found the truth of Christianity and they became heretics, and we are bringing them back to where they're supposed to be. Okay, so elches and then hijos, the children of this category. I was like, who are the elches? Who are these people? Come on, guys. Don't do this to me. It's too intense. Bereberes, the Berbers from North Africa. Huh? Turcos, the Turks. Ottomans and Turks, yeah? Turcos. Then you get Agareños. Agareños are the descendants of Hajar. So you got Ismail on one end. The descendants of Ismail, when Hajar is the mother. So the descendants of Hajar are called Agareños. Agar. And then Ismailitas, and then Ismailis. This is what they call the Muslims. Okay, what do they call Prophet Muhammad? Because Prophet Muhammad has, mashallah, he fills up the tank of creativity, business. I mean, he's not called Muhammad, never. Maometi, Maometo, Maometu. Maometitika, Maometani, Maometum, Maometus, Maometonorum, Maometismo, Maomet, oh my God. I mean, they're going wild. Somebody doesn't know what to do with their lives except just renaming. The same person is giving them such a hard time.
Adoradores de la luna.
Oh, wow.
Dicen, sí. En Houston, alguien dice, oh, Islam, oh, musulmanes. Ah, esos son los que adoran la luna.
I'll look it up. That's going to be my new keyword.
Yes.
Thank you so much. I'm going to look it up. The ones who worship the moon. Yes. I'm going to look it up. Thank you.
Houston. I listen.
The Jehovah's Witness.
Okay, so National Archives. Inquisition, yeah, Inquisition, these are the cases. To my surprise, the cases are mostly, okay, so yeah, these are my findings, yeah? So I expected, from my knowledge of history, and I showed you the timeline, my expectations or my hypothesis was, I'm going to find a lot of Islam at the beginning, and then it's going to disappear over time. That was my hypothesis. My findings show the opposite. There's not much going on 16th century, not much in 17th century. It peaks 18th century and there's a boom. What? Like, wait a minute. They're not going down. Like, this is not from up at the beginning. Because, you know, at the beginning, they just collapsed, and I understand, but then the Inquisition was after them, and then they were gone, and then by the time, the end of the Inquisition, they disappeared. That was my logic. Well, the findings are opposite of my logic. I still haven't answered why. I don't know why. I'm going crazy over what happened in the 1700s, because 1701, 1702, 1703, 1705, 1710, 1730, I was like, what happened in the 1700s? I mean, what's going on here? And then I get to the archive, the girl asks me, I found a document for you in 1816. Do you want it? I said, no. 1816 to 1820. I'm like, I don't want the document at the end of the Inquisition. What am I going to do with it? She's like, no, you have to see this. You got to see it. So page one, I'll show you. I'm going to show you. I mean, this is... So here, it says, Malvada secta de Mahoma, the evil sect of Muhammad. Right? This is my hand. My gloves. I'm going to show you what I do. This one here is, this guy was accused because he, I mean, his acusado, no? He's charged because he said el Quran de Mahoma era bueno. That's his charge. Yeah?
What is it?
El Quran de Mahoma era bueno. The Quran of Muhammad is good. It's a good book. Like, read it. It's a good book. Yeah?
He's the number one.
And then this one here, it says that diciendo que no había profeta que Mahoma. Like, there's no other prophet. The prophet is, I believe, one God, and Muhammad is his messenger. Right? This is it. Que no es Cristo. It's not Christ. I mean, he says Muhammad, and he said it's not Christ. Yeah? This is 1579. Oh, this is the one I want to show you. Yeah? This is the one, the latest case. the one I the rejected, the one I walked into the archives and I told her, I don't want this one. Please don't give it to me because I don't know how to explain it. So please, I don't want it. Don't give me something I can't explain. I mean, you're giving me 1816 to 1820, and then the first page, the guy confesses that he adores Muhammad and not Jesus. I mean, page one. This is not a guy who denies it. I have to go in and see how they torture him, and then they torture him, and then they go through the page one. Listen, guys, I am a Muslim, and I want to be burnt with green wood. Page one. Page one. Like, this is, I'm in your face. He's so blunt. He's so, like, in your face. You know, give me some leñas verdes. And acepta y reconoce que es moro. Like, page one. He does not waste time at all. Right here. Mahoma. First page. Right here. And Cristo is not, and I am not going to change my mind. And burn me, and let's just end this deal.
And this is in Mexico?
This is Mexico.
Okay.
Yeah, this is Mexico in 1816, 1820. The Inquisition ends when?
Still going on.
When does the Inquisition end? 1820. So this is a case that is takes me all the way to the end of the Inquisition. So I was like, okay, you know what? This is too intense for my system. I don't want cases that late. Give me what I know. Give me the beginning because that makes sense to my logic. Yes.
So what you're saying is that the Inquisition is still in full swing, even though it's about to end, it's still full speed ahead.
Yes, which brings me to why the Inquisition ends. A, the Inquisition ends because they can't find Muslims and Jews anymore, and they're tired of this business, and they're like, you know what? I can't find anybody, let's just call it a day, go home, relax, you know, sit in front of the TV with the popcorn, do something better with our lives. B, the Inquisition ends because somebody woke up in the morning and said, how cruel can we be? That's not what Jesus told us to do. We are just, what are we doing torturing people? Such a bad business to get into. Or C, because... I'm inviting you to think with me why the Inquisition ends. Or C, to look good.
To look good.
For who?
For who? So here comes, this is we're back in Spain. We're not in Mexico, we're in Spain. But remember, they're all connected. This is colonial time when Spain is the mom and these are her kids. Mm-hmm. Mexico all the way down to Argentina are the babies, yeah? Mm-hmm. And everybody's asking for independence from their mom. I don't want mommy anymore, I can do this by myself. Remember that time period? Okay, well, you have in Spain, Napoleon's soldiers are going into Madrid. And they pass by a religious monastery and disappear. So he sends a troop to find los soldados desaparecidos. He finds another group, he sends another troop. They go in, disappear. He sends another group to look for the desaparecido. I mean, let's find what's going on. Why they walk by this place, all of a sudden they disappear. So they go in, but this time they go in and search. Yeah? They go search, nice, beautiful carpets, silver stuff, I mean, just luxurious things, right? But that's it. That's the description of the French soldiers of what the place looks like. As they're leaving, they turn, and the priests are smiling at each other. Then they decide to go in and dig deeper. They remove the carpet. Find handles, levers, mm-hmm. Go in, tunnels, torture rooms, live humans on torture devices. 1800s. They go out and publish this to the whole Europeans, all of Europe. España, torturando, you know, they go, and then the French soldier described that they fainted at the sight. Because there were live women and babies.
Oh.
Women, babies on torture devices. So then when they published this, España, to wash its reputation, not true. Leyenda negra. This is a black legend. This is not true. It never happened. To prove it, we abolished the Inquisition.
Safe face.
Oh, you think we do this business? To prove it to you? We abolished the Inquisition. And it's funny. Very funny how they... abolish the Inquisition, but they can't live without it. They reinstill it quickly. They bring it back in because they're like, wait a minute, what did we just do? Did we just get rid of like the money making like business for us? Oh my God, how stupid are we? You know, let's just bring it back. And then they take it away. So then there's several dates of when the Inquisition ends. The Inquisition ends 1820 at the same time, same years of independence. when the Inquisition ends in Spain, by default, it ends in Mexico. The end. It wasn't because, I mean, if the French soldiers never landed in Madrid, we would still have an Inquisition alive and kicking today. Moral of the story is, this is not because we decided this is a cruel business, this is horrible, oh my God, what are we doing? No, this is because we want to protect an image of, you know, the reputation of Spain as la, you know, and then Spain was losing at the time, imagine, right after that is the decline of the Spanish Empire. Immediately with the loss of the Inquisition, the decline of the Spanish Empire, they lost all the colonies, they lost Puerto Rico, they lost Cuba, they start losing almost every battle they get into, they lost Gibraltar to the British took this out, they lost the Philippines, they just keep on losing. This big mega empire was like on the decline. Right after this Inquisition was, you know. Okay. How the Inquisition, here we go. They were trying to tell the priests, the sacerdotes, that, you know, Christianity is better and your life will be better. And he was just like, I'm not, I'm Muslim, and just deal with it. just burn me and let's call it a day. Because I know I'm done, so yeah, let's just do it. You know what I mean? I'm ready for this. Yeah? So how does it work? This case was found in something called bienes nacionales, national
goods.
No. National. You know how we talk about national security today? You know how we talk about how the importance of national security and treasury? Yeah. So bienes nacionales is a rama de Inquisición. Is one branch of Inquisition where it's for assets. Yeah, for nationalized assets and, well, you know. Anyways, so let's say, I'll use Jalil. Let's say Jalil is, you know, he's, mashallah, a successful person, has property assets and stuff, but, you know, I have a problem with him. Well, I'm a crypto Muslim. I know he's Muslim. But the best way to protect there's two things. I'm going through financial crisis. I need some quick cash. I don't really like the guy, you know. So what am I going to do?
Rat him out.
If I call him out, it makes me a good Christian because nobody calls me out. So I go first. I call him out. Actually, he's a crypto Muslim. That means I am a very good Christian. Are you with me?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah? But then they come after him. And they do the interrogation. They figure out he's got assets to give to the treasury. So the way they divide the thing, the estate, one third goes to me, one third of his wealth, one third goes to the church, and one third goes to the state.
The crown.
Which is who? Spain. So they give one third to Spain. Look at how Spain got rich. Somebody has to write a book like this, How Spain Got Rich. You know? So really, the crown, then the church, how the church got rich. That's another book. You know? And then I get some money. Not just money. Forget the money I get. I got a protection from ever becoming an Inquisition subject. Me and my family are protected because I did that.
Immunity.
So by conspiring with the system, by becoming part of the system, is the way I get protection for myself.
Like communism, people used to call people like, you know, here's a communist.
So when you call somebody out,
you become the hero.
You're the hero.
Yes.
You become the hero.
You're patriotic.
Yeah, that's your, exactly. Your patriotism is by turning in your fellow people. And it was happening between family members.
And Muslim.
Wife and husband. Wife and husband. Wife wants a divorce. You're not going to divorce me. I'm going to call you out. Hey, he's a crypto Jew. He's gone. See you later, buddy. So the castle of Inquisición is going to take care of you. She gets a third of his wealth. You want to give me divorce fair game? Let's do this. All right. So it's women accusing husbands. Husbands accusing wives. Very common. So I have something called diligencias matrimoniales. I work on that one, you know? All the people who have family problems who solve it in the Inquisition house. You don't want to do fair? Oh, you want to take the kids away from me? No problem. Hey, crypto Muslim right here, dude. I mean, you know, he's wearing camisa blanca. Just get rid of him. You know, he's out. He's out. Whether it's fair or not fair, whether it's right or not right, this is a system of the time. This is not to judge it. This is just to state it. To divide the people. Yeah, it was a system to divide. So these are the edicts and how big they are. Yeah? Look at how they issued these edicts. Yeah, contra la secta de Mahoma. Just want to share with you. Can we have time to read? Or?
Yeah, we have.
Yeah? Okay, this edict was key for me because it helped me with my keywords on what I need to search.
Let me ask the audience. Do we have, is that good? Pretty good?
Can I keep going?
Yeah.
You guys are okay? Yeah, okay. So let's just do this. So, I'm zooming on this one, right? This is the edict, and I'm just zooming in so you can read more. Okay? Same page. So, si sabéis o habéis oído decir que algunas personas hayan dicho o afirmado que la secta de Mahoma es buena, y que no hay otro para entrar al paraíso, ¿no? No hay otra, perdón, para entrar en paraíso. Y que Jesucristo no es Dios, sino profeta. Y que no nació de Nuestra Señora siendo virgen antes del parto, en el parto y después del parto. Y no hayan dicho algunos ritos y ceremonias de la secta de Mahoma por guarda y observancia de ella. Así como si hubiesen guardado los viernes por santo, como comiendo carne en ellos y otros días prohibidos de la Santa Madre Iglesia, diciendo que no es pecado, vistiéndose en los dichos viernes con camisas limpias. I mean, right here. Uh-huh. The camisa limpia is the problem, you guys. They're right here. If they wear
a clean shirt,
right? Right here, they're saying, if you find somebody says that the Virgin Mary was a virgin before, I mean, look at the description. A virgin before birth, during birth, and after birth. I mean, the question is, who cares? But anyway, that doesn't matter. Who cares if she was? Y otras ropas de fiesta. Y hayan degollado aves, halal meat. They're going after halal meat, okay? So if you...
And they have slaughtered.
And slaughtered the chicken.
Chicken.
If you slaughter your chicken, right? Degollado aves, o reses, or beef, yeah? Otra cosa, atravesando el cuchillo, like if you're atravesando el cuchillo, like if you're like making the chicken, the
bringing through the knife, like
butcher, the butcher. But also there was another document where afilando el cuchillo, like if you actually have if you sharpen the knife before you kill the animal, that's a halal business thing. Go for it. Like if you find somebody, you sharpen the knife. That's what you put. That's your target, you know. Go after this knife. Go in the kitchen. Go in the kitchen and do that. Okay. Dejando la nuez en la cabeza, volviendo la cara hacia el alquibla. So of course that was my keyword. Alquibla became one of my keywords. They're looking for an animal that has its face directed towards the qibla, right? Y que hacia el oriente. So if you go to the east. They know exactly what qibla is east. I mean, these guys, they're not joking, you know? Diciendo, Bismillah. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. You know, this is the Bismillah is in Spanish, right here. Bismillah, no? Diciendo, Bismillah y atando los pies a los reses. So, I mean, if you kill the animal and you tie the feet, you're in trouble. You gotta let the feet loose, right? O que no coman ninguna de aves que están por degollar, ni estén degolladas de mano de mujer. I don't know why they have a problem with women slaughtering in the kitchen. But if the women slaughter, I mean, apparently they think Muslims don't do that. Again, this is their understanding of what Islam is. Yeah? This is the church understanding what Islam is. Yeah? Ni queriéndolas degollar las dichas mujeres porque están prohibido en la secta de Mahoma. Y no hayan retajado a sus hijos poniéndoles nombres de moros. So they make their children name Omar. Think of Omar, very popular in Mexico. Like names like Fatima. Names, they put the children's names are Muslim. Y llamándose así, y se llaman nombres de moros que le hubiese que llaman. Okay. Y que hayan dicho que no hay más Dios y Mahoma es su mensajero. Shahed. Basically, they say, La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah, just go get them. O que hayan jurado por al-Kibra. They swear by God. Like al-Kibra. I don't know what Kibra is, but I looked it up. but they swear by it. O dicho a la yamin sula. I think this is wallah al-azim. Because they swearing by Allah, right? So this is the swearing, the Spanish adaptation of how Muslims swear. Y que quieran decir por todos los juramentos. Y que hayan ayunado el ayuno de Ramadan. Like they fast, not Ramadan, Ramadan. Okay? Ramadan is the fast, right? Y guardando su Pascua. Pascua is Eid. Yeah? So they have the Eid. Dando en ella a los pobres limosna. They give to the poor charity. Yeah? The sadaqah and zakah is a problem. The sadaqah and zakah are a problem. If you find somebody helping the people who are poor, go after them. Because, hey, why are you giving the poor if you can give it to the church?
Because it's the church's business.
Why are you helping the poor people? I mean, the church is supposed to be helping, right? The poor people? But no, I mean, if you're helping the poor, I mean, what's wrong with you? Put it in the basket, like an asta. Put the money in the basket right here. You don't give the poor, we are in charge. Yeah, you got that concept? Okay, dando a los pobres limosna y no comiendo ni viviendo en todo el día. This is describing Ramadan, the fasting.
They're not eating or drinking all day.
Hasta la noche. Until nighttime, they break their fast. Yeah? Saliendo la estrella. Like when the stars come out, that's when they break their fast. Comiendo carne y lo que quieran. They eat meat or they eat whatever they want. Meat, because you know the fasting of the Christians, there's no meat. That's why they stress it so much. Yeah, the difference between the Christian fast and the Muslim fast is what? You eat meat? You know, like on Fridays, the
fish.
Yeah, the fish. Yeah, yeah. Y que lo que quieran. Okay, I have dicho, I hecho el sahur. Sahur. Yeah? So they were chasing people who do. So they come to your house like early in the morning to figure out if you're eating before the sunrise. Like they actually, like, I don't know if they're in your bed or they're hiding in your under your bed. I'm not sure how these guys get.
I'm sure they had people who like Gestapo. I'm sure they had people go to the streets.
Yes.
Yes.
To search for informants. Yeah. Thank you. Look at the kind of society that was going on, huh? Sahur, levantándose en las mañanas antes de amanezca, que amanezca, a comer, y después de haber comido, lávense la boca. So they know that after you eat sahur, you wash your mouth. I don't know, they come with you to the bathroom. They come, huh? Like, because you know how you clean your mouth because you're starting your fast? Y tornándose a la cama. Like they go to sleep after the sahur. So I'm not sure at what point they get you. When you get to the bed, when you wake up to eat, what part of it is fishy? Y que hayan hecho el guadoc, el wudu. Yeah, el guadoc, lavándose, look at what they do for the wudu. Lavándose los brazos, las manos, a los codos, la cara, la boca, nariz, oído, piernas y partes vergonzosas. I mean, they know you wash your private part in wudu. So they're with you in the bathroom. You're not just washing your mouth and your arms and your legs, you're washing your private parts, and we're on it. We're on it. We're with you on this one. Oh my God. I mean, put yourself in my shoes. I'm reading this document in the archive. I'm like, what is going on here?
And that's why they close. You said they close the house.
Close the houses.
Yes.
So no one can see.
No one can see what's going on.
Yeah.
Y que hayan hecho después en salón.
Subhanallah.
Volviéndose la cara hacia el Qibla. One more time, they got an issue with the Qibla. I mean, when you pray, you go to the Qibla, the halal meat to the Qibla, and you know, they go to the Qibla very well. Diciendo ciertas palabras en arábigo. They say Arabic words when they put their face towards the Qibla, which is, you know, the salah. Rezando la oración de Andalulay. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Andalulay, Fatiha. Y kul huwa. The kul huwa, you know what I mean? You got the oración de kul huwa, you know? Andalulay is Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, no? La oración de kul huwa y guahad. Kul huwa Allahu ahad. Kul huwa y they think it's something else. They don't know. You see how they don't know? Kul huwa Allahu واحد. We got that one. If you say أحد, you know, أحد أحد. Y otras oraciones de moros. And another prayers that Muslims pray. Y no coman tocino. They don't eat bacon, pork. Y no beben vino. Don't drink alcohol. Wine. Yeah? Por guarda y observanza de la secta de los moros. Because that's what the sect of the moors do. Y que hayan guardado la Pascua del Carnero. They also celebrate Pascua, Eid, Carnero, Eid al-Adha.
With the lamb.
With the lamb. Yeah? Habiéndose muerto y haciendo... Huh? These are the crimes. Yes.
You know, it's, I know we laugh at this, but this is actually kind of scary because this shows how detailed that they're looking for, that they're system, this is a systematic hunting down of the Muslims.
Yes.
This is system, it's systematic. I mean, we laugh at this because they're very descriptive in the descriptions that they get, but this is very, this is actually very frightening because there's actually a systematic tracking and hunting down of Muslims. Yes.
Yeah, it's like central intelligence. Right?
Yeah, Gestapo. Yeah.
So how we know those, is that like, what's those papers like? Is that church?
This is an edict. Edict. A law. Issued.
Yes.
You know how many times I found this? 280 times. In 250 years. This is not one edict. These are several edicts.
Of course, we're talking about a group of Christians that are not following a right way of Christianity.
No, no, no. These are called Los Franciscanos, Los Dominicos. This is a religious order called Dominics, and it is part of Catholicism, and their job is to do the Inquisition. That's their job. They did it. It's the one with the dog. You know Santo Domingo, the island Santo Domingo? There's a country called Santo Domingo? Yeah? Dominicos are the ones responsible for this. They do nothing else. They have a dog, the perro, no? Dominicos, they have... You can enter the church, Dominicus Church, that was a dog. Find the dog, find Dominicus, this is what they did. That's their job. Their job, you know, there's Jesuits, the Jesuitas, Carmelitas, Franciscanos, but this one is the Dominicans' business.
So this is from the main, like, it's not like only sect. But
no, 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 this is not a sect. This is created for this. I mean, the Dominicos... They're created to perform this within Catholicism, and they are under the Pope. This is under the blessings of the Pope. This is not one sect doing something weird because they're out of Christianity. No, 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 no. This is the umbrella of Catholicism, the blessings of the Pope, doing the business of God that you're supposed to be doing. But since we can't have everybody do that, we dedicate a specific group called Los Dominicos to get this hunting down business.
Probably they have the same thing for a Jew. They have some...
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. The edict has the Jews, Luteranos. They were looking for the Lutherans, the Luteranos, Martin Luther from the Protestants. They're looking for alumbrados. They're looking for homosexuales. They're looking for a bunch of other people. But this, they're also looking for Muslims.
These are like the secret
agents. Yeah, like the CIA.
They're not just looking for Muslims. This is not an anti-Muslim only. No. But the key is when I'm in the Inquisition Museum, there's a list of all the people charged in the Inquisition, and in that list, there are no Muslims. So I go to the Inquisition Museum. One of the things I would like to change is for them to incorporate, after all these documents out and about, to consider that Muslims were victims of the Inquisition. Because they got alumbrados. Alumbrados is like one little baby sect of Christianity that, you know. So they got, or Luteranos, the Lutherans, but they don't consider Muslims after everything that's happened. Yeah. And of course they have the Jews. Huh? Of course the Jews are on top of the list. Yeah. Persecution. So this is edict that looks for specific outside characteristics that make people Muslim.
How is this taught in regular public schools?
It's not taught.
It's not taught.
Nobody knows about this.
The conversation took care of a one statement, summarize everything.
No, 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 no. The public understands their identity as such. We are Spanish mixed with Indians, natives, period. We did the mestizaje, we did the salad bowl, and this is who we are. The salad bowl of Indians with Spanish, and maybe we got some African, the Afro-Cubano, and then we're set.
So they beautify it.
Huh?
Beautify it.
And the hierarchy in society is if you have more Spanish blood in you, you're higher than if you have more indigenous blood in you. If you're indigenous only, then mixed with Spanish, then you're really at the bottom of the pit. No. But if you're like a mestizaje, which is the majority of the people who mixed in blood and none, then you're... But if you're Spanish descent only, then you have a higher ranking in society. That's it. It's a colonial system.
Keep going.
So now I'm going to show you that the books that were prohibited in colonial Mexico is the Quran, right? So we have here.
So all of this is, I'm sorry, all of this is in Mexico right now.
This is
you're not talking about Spain anymore.
No.
Well, Nueva España is not just Mexico. Nueva España is Texas, where we are. Texas, the parts that were, you know, all of Spain, all the way to Guatemala and the Philippines. So Mexico is not what we know Mexico today.
But not Spain. Now you're not talking about Spain.
Nueva Spain.
No, this is Nueva España.
Okay.
New Spain.
Okay.
Yeah?
Colombia.
Wow.
Not yet. I haven't.
So all these repetitions are in
Nueva España. Yes, here.
Not.
Right here. Okay, I'm going to read this edict, and this is the edict against the Quran, okay? So, libros prohibidos, prohibited books. Si sabéis o habéis oído decir que algunas personas hayan tenido o tenido libros de la secta o opiniones del dicho Martín Lutero, right here, Martin Luther and Protestant, y otros herejes, and other heretics, o el Alcorán. Otra secta de Mahoma, right? So, show you that the books from this letter right here, Arabic letter from a nephew to his son, to his uncle in the Inquisition. And what's interesting is the date. The date of the letter is...
what does it say?
The... إلى حضرة الخال العزيز المكرم المعلم موسى سلمه الله تعالى أولا يزيدكم الأشواق أريكم كل خير وعافية الشريف علمكم I have it more, I have it all written down actually. I edited the whole thing. I wrote it down in more. But he's talking to his uncle and he's telling him, and it's on the side and the edge, and he wants to make sure his uncle is okay in the jails of Inquisition.
And this is here. I mean, someone here.
This is Mexico City.
Someone who's Arab and writing this.
This is Spanish Muslims. I mean, I don't know. I mean, this is, his name is Moises or something. His name, what's his name? I'll show you his name. Moises Francisco Matar. And his address is No Tiene Pila en la Ciudad de México. I mean, he's from Mexico City.
Almatar.
His name is Musa. Moises.
Musa Matar.
Musa Matar.
Okay. And what's interesting is the year, this is 1750. This is from the south of Mexico, Oaxaca. The archive is gorgeous, yeah? This is the Códice de Yahuintlán, 1520 to 1544. You guys know history now, what that means. 1500s, it's early. The Inquisition was instilled in Mexico 1570s. This is right before the Inquisition. And they're describing what the conquistadors look like, right? So you have the sombrero and the beard. That looks Spanish or Mexican. But then you also have this. Yeah?
Same.
Yeah, you see that? Mm-hmm. Okay, now I want to show you the next. Oh, and so this shows you the society. You got the priests, you got the Indians. Okay, can you see?
Same.
Then you get the Spanish. This is the Spanish side.
Interesting.
But this is Spanish too. Okay? Then you get this. And because you guys are Muslims, I'm not going to tell you what that means.
One.
You see the finger? Do you see the finger?
Yes.
So you guys got it?
Yes.
Like it's obvious?
Obvious.
No doubts?
No doubts.
Every single one has a finger.
Yeah. Yeah. That's usually best as you do that.
Every single one has a finger up. And look at the beads.
Right.
The beads of the
spear.
Yeah?
33.
Okay, same place. There's a box, cotton candy box. Here, we have something for you, and we don't know what it is. Maybe you can understand it. We have these, documents that we don't even know what they are. Maybe they're quizás son interesantes para ti. This is exactly how I was presented. So I open this, and they're wrapped in a piece of paper. Like, remember, this is it. This is the one here and one here. Okay. Es un corancito. Corancito. El al corancito.
This is not the whole Quran, right?
The whole thing, from A to Z.
That's the whole Quran.
The entire thing from A to Z.
Handwritten.
Cuéntanos, tell us when you found this, and then you came back into the monastery or the and then they hide it for you.
Oh yeah, yeah. The first time I saw it, I had access to it. After this, it was like very hard to see.
Yeah.
When I told them what it is, when I know what it is, yeah.
¿En qué parte lo encontraste?
Oaxaca.
Al Oaxaca.
La biblioteca de Burgos. La biblioteca de Burgos, en el sur.
They tried so hard to erase it, but they just can't do it.
Size of a coin. Size of a coin. Now you see that sometimes, in, like, you know, Muslims have, like, for baraka or for something, they have it. But this one is not for baraka. This is for reading. Because there's a magnifying, I found in Spain, a magnifying device that they created for these books. So there is, like, a little clip that holds the book from edge to edge with a magnifying glass on top, and you can read it. So this is not, this is designed to be read with a magnifying glass, but you can pocket size it, you can hide it.
You have to hide it. Yes.
You have to hide it. Pocket size it, hide it. And here's the other one. Snake skin. Yeah, handwritten.
The whole Quran.
The whole thing from beginning to end. From the Fatiha to Surah An-Nas.
People at the archive, do they know that that's Arabic?
No.
No.
They don't know what they have, Sheikh.
They don't know what they have.
I'll tell you something interesting, because every time that you open this National Archive, you sign, when was the last person who opened this document? Because there is a hidden history for, wow, 100 years? Until you open them?
Yeah, who was the last person to see these documents?
Before you.
Before you.
I need to find out.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's interesting.
Wrong in the government.
But nobody knows what it is. I created the feature. Like, I did the feature in the archives. They asked me, can you please, like, describe and tell us what it is? Because we don't even know what it is.
Feature is like a tag, basically, what it is. So they bring it to her.
So it's my handwriting. If you go there and you see the feature, I created the feature of this place. You know,
so they just bring some things and they say, this may be of interest to you.
But he, because he told me, because I told him I'm looking for Arabic documents. He's like, well, I don't know what Arabic is. I have a whole box called Otras Lenguas. Like other languages, right? So, I looked at different things. I looked at Nahuatl. I looked at
Mixteco.
Mixteco. Then I also looked at Arameo. Aramaic. And Syriaco.
Syriac.
And then I found this.
Syrian.
Yeah, I found all these languages, by the way, are there. If somebody is specialist in Syriaco, there's a bunch of documents in Syriaco. There's a bunch of documents on Arameo.
Really?
Like not, yeah, a lot. Yes.
El doc tiene documentos inclusive en Copto, en Monterrey.
Yeah.
Are there any dates written on
these? Anonymous, no dates. What we want to do with the researchers, with the team of researchers, is to study it. To bring someone specialist to analyze the paper, the time, and everything. So we want to actually do that work. We want to figure out the timing. Yes.
Is that the entire length of the snake? Is it one sheet?
No. It's a tiny little thing.
No, this the roll. You said it was snake skin?
The outside only. Look.
Oh,
the cover.
Oh, never mind.
The cover. But we want to know, actually, the snake is very interesting, because we want to know if the snake is a Mesoamerican snake.
Wow.
Yeah, we want to figure out if it's a document that came from Spain or it's a created document in here. We want to figure out if it's a Meso, because a snake is very important in Mesoamerican tradition.
Yes.
Yeah.
So we want to understand if this is a snake from Mesoamerica or came from Spain or came from where.
That's if you're going to find it again.
That's why we need to do the documentary. So I'm going to show you like this. So of course, when I arrived to the archives and I found the stuff, the director of the archive was looking for me. So the next time I show up, they're like,
"We have more stuff for you."
No, where were you? Like, why? I thought there's something. I did something wrong, right? Oh my God, what happened? No, where were you? The director is looking for you, and every single day I'm on the hunt for you. What did I do? Did I destroy a document? Is something missing? I wasn't sure. Like, no, you can't leave. She has to talk to you. You can't leave. So I had to sit in the archive, wait for her to come. And she's the one who actually held it. I couldn't hold it. I was trembling. I was shaking. I was crying. I couldn't hold it. I was like, I can't touch this thing. I can't touch this thing. I can't touch it. Oh my God, what if I destroy it? I don't want to touch it, you know? So she did it, and I took the pictures in her hands, yeah? And then in the same place, I found this document, 1698, which is, you guys know what 1698 is now. This is not 1500, but what I want, yeah? 1698. Lex Evangelica contra Alcoranum. Evangelical law against the Quran. A thick document like this, verse by verse, attacking. First page, Muhammad is a liar. Second page, Muhammad is a crazy. Third, exactly what the Quran says. You know how the Quran says they would call you a liar, they would call you crazy, they would call you... Every page is exactly what the book is. And then, this is just the introduction to the book. Then you continue the book. Page 1, Surah Al-Fatiha, why this is a fabrication. Page 2, Al-Baqarah, verse by verse, attacking him. Page 3, I mean, this is just the entire Quran, thick letter. And I did find one, I found 6 copies. And the 6 copies are from where? One copy is Franciscanos. Another copy is Jesuita. Another copy is Carmelita. Another copy is... I mean, I'm not kidding. I had to learn the religious orders to figure out why they have 6 copies of the same legs. Now, we go to the opposite of what I found in Spain, which is called, this one is called the Brevario Sunni. It has nothing to do with Sunnah, it's just a manual on how to practice Islam in the Spanish language. And it's the opposite. In Spain, they were writing Spanish in Arabic script. Here, they're writing Arabic in Latin script. So it goes like this. This one is called Oración del Hamdu, the prayer of Alhamdu, yeah? Oración del Hamdu, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, Maliki Yawm al-Din, Iyaka Na'budu wa Iyaka Nasta'inu, Ihdina Sirata al-Mustaqima, Sirata al-Ladhina An'amta Alayhim, Ghayr al-Maghdubi Alayhim, Wala Dallina. Spanish, que quiere decir, alabado sea Dios, creador de los cielos, sabios, el misericordioso que ha de misericordia, emperador del día de la ley, a ti adoramos, tú eres nuestro refugio, tú nos guía por el verdadero camino. Camino que prometiste a aquellos moros y no sus enemigos cristianos. Y no a los que andan errado, este del libro del Alcorán. No. When I found the legs, oh my God, I found the brevario, oh my God, I didn't do anything for a week. For a whole week, I couldn't do anything. I was like, oh my God, what's going on here? Oh my God, why is it here? Who are these people? Who are these people? Like, it was really, of course I cried my eyes out. You know, couldn't take it. I was like, oh my God, they try to cover it so hard. I'm like, wow, these people are trying to say how to practice Islam, basically, like the Quran, this is, you know?
They're trying to practice their faith and hide it at the same time.
And hide it at the same time. Yeah? And then this one is the Kulhua. The one they were hunting in the, you know, the Kulhua. The Kulhua one, I found it. You know what I mean? La oración de, yeah?
Ahadun.
Ahadun, yeah. Qul huwa Allahu ahadun. Allahu samad. Hold on. Is this the one?
Yeah.
Yeah? Samad.
Yeah.
Quiere decir, hold on. Dios es uno. Solo Dios es preciosísimo. No engendra, ni ha engendrado, ni tiene semejante.
That's it.
End of the story.
It says God is the most precious. That's what it says.
That's the end of Christianity, right there.
You know, prior to this in the Fatiha, it says the emperor of the day of the law.
Allah
was like, if you look at the Spanish, it's so deep.
It's beautiful.
It's beautiful. It's
and it's actually a better translation.
It hits you at a better translation than English.
And it hits you a better translation than the Spanish Quran today.
Yeah.
Solo Dios es preciosísimo. Like amazing. Altísimo.
When you read the Quran, I don't interrupt you, but when you read the Quran, Al-Fatiha, there is two way of reciting Al-Fatiha, right? There is Hafs, we call, which is the language of Quraysh, and there is Warsh, which is an outside of Quraysh. So you recited Maliki Yawmiddin, the owner of the day of judgment of the law, right? And you can recite it worse with people of the North Africa recite, they say Maliki Yawmiddin.
That's exactly what I know.
Exactly. So that's what from North Africa, Maliki means the king or the emperor.
That's why,
yes.
That's why
they said the that's why the translation. That's the two-way pronunciations. The Maliki al-Middin and like the school of Morocco.
So this traces to the Maliki, which was the Maliki school of Maliki, Maliki yes. Fiqh, of course. Yes. This is Maliki Fiqh.
Say Maliki al-Middin.
Yeah, and Spain and Morocco followed the same school of Fiqh.
All the Muslims that came over here followed
Maliki. Maliki, obviously, yes.
Maliki, yeah.
It's the madhab of the Americas.
But it's the same meaning. Yeah. Maliki and Maliki.
And you know, I'm sorry, but at the end, beyond the Fatiha, it says, and this was the way of the people who followed.
SubhanAllah.
Like in Spanish, it's like, this is the way of the people who followed. So it's almost like
el you're giving
el camino, the way, the path. So they don't identify it so precisely, so they can't be hunted down. But yet, people who understand this will understand.
Oh yes. La ilaha illallah. And look at where we are today. Look at where we are today. Yeah.
So did you discover different other stealth forms for them to save something of their identity, yet at the same time to stay under the radar?
Well, there are things like Calavera de Puebla, like the work. You can see it in the workmanship, in the economic system. Like how the architecture, you can see it in the diet, very much so, the diet. Much less pork in Mexico, for instance, than Spain. Spain pork is everything. In Mexico, the diversity in the food, you can avoid it. You can actually live without it. In Spain, you can't live without pork. Yeah. And then, I just want to show you. I don't know what's left here. Let me see.
What about even the Spanish language? Because if you go back to English 200-300 years ago, it's a very different English. It's hard to read and understand.
What's interesting about the Spanish language is, you know, there's differentiation between words, like synonyms. The Arabized version of the word is the Mexican one. Then the Latinized form is the Spanish one. When I say Spanish, it's in Spain, no? So piscina is Latin, alberca is Arabic, which is the same thing. So why do you say alberca in Mexico and not call it piscina? It's the Arabic version of the word.
Yeah?
But I want to show you this. Hold on, not sure how to go back and show you this culture. Today, in a place called Zacateca, they still celebrate something called La Fiesta de Moros y Cristianos. Yeah? Of course, in Spain. I'm talking about, this is Mexico. I'm hunting to see if, you know, so why do you have Fiesta de Moros y Cristianos? And they do this, right? They dress up as Moros, and it's like, actually, the state of Zacateca invited me to present this here and to explain La Fiesta de Moros y Cristianos.
The party of Moors and Christians, that's what it's called. This
yeah? And then some aspects that you could see in Mexico, he was asking the question. So Islamic art, architecture, like geometrical. And then Abu Mujahid is not here. ¿Dónde está? Ah, perdón. Porque usted dijo agua, ¿no? Entonces los elementos son aire, agua, luz, sonido. These are the four components of that you could feel in the architecture. Arcos, fuentes, puertas, techos, minaretes, torres, patio, ambiente privado, las casas, geometría, no hay escultura, caligrafía, all the aspects, yeah?
Air, water, light, and sound are the things you can feel from the architecture.
Architecture, this would be North Africa. This is North Africa, and this is Mexico. Okay, this is North Africa, and this is Morocco, and then this is Africa, which is Andalusian style, you know, the Andalusian art. Yeah? And then you have this right here. This is Chiapas. And then you have, this is Mexico City when it wanted to compete in the world in 1800s in Europe, in France. To compete, they competed with this, something called Pabellón Morisco, which is like Islamic architecture. And they won. Yeah. They competed and won with an Islamic art, Mexico City.
We did a, you remember,
yes,
the day we met, mashallah, they're in Mexico. We had a conference, And it was walking distance from this. And to be able to leave this Islamic conference and come down here and just be there, it is amazing.
It's beautiful.
In Mexico City. Yeah.
Someone said, look at the colonial architecture, which is like Islamic architecture. Yeah, they call it colonial, right? Mm-hmm. And then the concept of azulejo. The difference, or you see the Christianization of it, is the statues and maybe the crosses, the mosaic. But the concept of mosaic and the concept of putting something together, it was this was all Islamic, no? Azulejo. And then you have this one here. This is Spain, right? And then just the geometrical, what you see here.
That's
what you guys see here, basically.
We put these symbols here for these concepts.
We need this one, though.
Deeper.
Guys, we need this one.
Well,
Let's pull the Granada, we need it. Please. Adapt this and make it part of it. It's called, there's no conqueror, no hay vencedor except Allah. Right? There's no conqueror except Allah.
And it's a shield or an arm.
And is it still in the Alhambra? Is it still all over on the palace?
I want to show you the fountains, the concept of that. Something really significant is towers, okay? Anybody from Syria? Half Syrian? Anybody Syrian? Well, the Umayyads in Syria are the ones who went to Al-Andalus. And there's the structure of the tower, the Umayyad structure is the square tower. Not the circle, not the pencil. Pencil is the Ottoman Empire. The circle one, it's Abbasid.
Mm-hmm.
And then you have this. But the square tower is the tower in Latin America.
Oh my God.
Mm-hmm. It's the Umayyad structure, Umayyad architecture. From a specific time period and definitely linked to Spain. Lights, techos de madera, woodwork, and then definitely the beauty of arches that came from Spain, and then the art of making an arch, and a mihrab, and nichos. Concept of Nietzsche, this concept that came from the work that came from Spain, is all Spain, right? The workmanship, but all of this is transformed, and you can see it in, all of this. The work, the elaborate work, the beauty in making something, the ihsan, the beautifying. You can see this in the woodwork, you can see it in the stucco, definitely stucco. With this concept of like working something and doing
it as with excellence, right?
Excellent.
So it was the way that they were proclaiming the deen to be in the architecture, and even the green and everything they did with ihsan, and the green and the running and flowing water was the representation of what Allah mentioned about Jannah. So they created a reality here that prepared them for the hereafter.
Ma'arafu mashihan.
No, there was none of them. It was very, they're very specific and hard, a lot of hard work. And built infrastructure, left things behind. Like, there's always the concept of the Sadaqa Jariya concept. I build it and others benefit from it. And I'm okay with that. I have no problem building something, a bridge, a city, infrastructure, aqueduct, water, designing, protecting, all of this, there's no problem in building something that would benefit others in the future. Be it in agriculture, architecture, medicine, herbs. There's a whole field of herbs I didn't get into, how they're getting into how Muslims cure with herbs. And the prophetic, how the Muslims use certain leaves to cure things. All of this is in the archives. So nothing is labeled Muslim. But if you are Muslim, you know what to find. And you know how to find it, and when you find it, you know it's Muslim. So yes, I am a Muslim researcher, and obviously I look like I have an agenda or something to prove, or I'm trying to prove that Islam was there, or I'm trying to make something happen that doesn't exist, but the documents make history.
The evidence is there.
Documents make history. This is not, I didn't know what I was going to find. You know what I mean? Like, this is the documents imposing on me the work and the exercise to really explain what's going on. Yes.
I don't know if you maybe have mentioned this before, but I remember over 20 years ago I had met a Caucasian convert from California who had mentioned that one of the tactics that the Muslims use to save their identity, because this being conquered by the Christians and then taken over again in Spain and in the Iberian Peninsula happened so often, that they added "ez" to the end of their last names. so that they would be identified by such as Hernandez.
The EZ in the end, what I know from linguistics, is EZ means Ibn, or son of. But that could be Jewish or Muslim. There's a lot of Jewish-Muslim parallels. So it's very important for the Jew to be Benu Israel, Ben Ezra, Ben. But also in the Muslim world, it's so important where you come from, who your family is, Ibn Mien. You know, like who your El, who? Al Imran, you know, like who, which family are you from, you know? So the EZ, definitely, it means son of. So the son of Alvaro is Alvarez. Son of Fernando is Fernandez. No, so the Fernandez is the son, you see what I mean?
Yeah.
Gonzalo is González. Hernan, Hernandez. So all the EZs are son of that person. Wled, Ibn Hernando, Ibn, you know? Not too much is known on genealogy, whether the EZ is Jewish or Muslim. The Jews claim it. When I was in the Sephardic Museum, all the EZs are claimed by the Jews. And they can, because they're Ibn, and they can all be Jews. They claim, I was shocked. There is a rotating, spinning alphabetical order last names. They basically claim 98% of last names in Spanish to be Jewish last names. They claim everything to be Jewish. Everything, even including the ones with Al. Alvarez, you know. No, Alfonso can't get any more Christian than that. Sancho and Alfonso can't get any more Christian names than that. No, these are actually like the ones that won't be Muslim or Jewish. Alfonso and Sancho. They're the ones who conquered the London. Sanchez and Alfonso. Sanchez. Sancho. No, Sancho, not Sanchez. Sancho and Alfonso are for sure
Christian.
Yeah.
There's no Arabic tie whatsoever.
Sorry. But I want to zoom out before I finish. I just want to take this into a contemporary spin, because we are standing here as the historical stuff that we're doing right here. Because we're connecting past to present, yeah? So the fact that I was able to see continuum in this journey of search for documents from Spain all the way to New Spain, makes me wonder, could it be, you know, when I stand in my prayers and I do the Abrahamic dua, you know, wa min dhurriyati, Rabbana wa taqabbal dua, may Allah accept from me that it's not just me and my children, but me and my descendants. Could it be that you guys bumped into it? Because, I mean, in terms of Muslims doing dawah and doing the work that we're supposed to do, we're not knocking doors and evangelizing. We're not doing anything. If not, we're doing anti-dawah. The only thing we contribute is maybe a terrorist here and you know, bad news there and media here. I mean, not we, but I'm saying to the world, like to the vision of how Islam is portrayed. Does not make sense at all for people to be attracted to it. Does not make sense, even women to be attracted to it. With all the image of women in Islam and, you know, beat up and domestic violence and, you know, walking behind the men and no rights and no driving and all the stuff that they promote about Muslim women. So if you notice, more than 80% of converts, Latino converts, are women. And they're finding it without effort. I ask, why?
Your ancestors.
I don't. And then yesterday I was looking at the, you know, Mujahid's DNA, and I was like, wow. He did the DNA testing, and you know, he was showing it to me, and I'm explaining it to him. Like, I guess like I went through the list, and I'm like, oh my god, 1,000 years of history right here, right here, summarized in one human, you know, standing. So he's got genetics that go from Saudi Arabia, Medina, like the journey from Medina to Damascus, from Damascus to Berber, North Africa, from Berber to Spain, to Jewish Sephardic, to mixed with indigenous in Colombia, Ecuador, to here to find out who he is. He's a journey of migration, a journey of migration of a people from place to place looking for what? Dean. I was in awe yesterday. I was like, oh my god, this is very emotional. This is too intense for my eyes. And I looked at the map and this is too intense for me. I can't take this anymore.
For that reason, the 12th of October, okay, the day of the race, no? 12 de octubre.
Día de la raza.
Y yo digo, ¿cuál raza? Si somos un poco mezclados.
Yeah. And then, you know, his last name is Fletcher, so he's looking for the British part of him. You know, I want to embrace my Fletcher side. You know what I mean? This is who I am, a Fletcher. And he's like less than 1% British. The rest is like, is the majority is like the other, you know, salad bowl. I mean, I was like, wow, where's the Fletcher? I want to find the Fletcher. Find the British side of him, you know?
Todo el tiempo, always, I was born in Palmira, Valle del Cauca, Colombia. Palmira. A lot of person, they said, Palmira, the capital in agriculture in Colombia. Another, they said, Palmira, oh, beautiful palms in the whole city. That's not true. Palmira is one of the beautiful cities in Syria. The UNESCO said one of the best monuments in Syria. Palmira, the name is in Syria. For what reason?
We don't know.
We don't know. But when I showed that in Colombia, they said, wow, that's true? That's true? Nobody knows. For that reason, we are in Islam in Spanish. We are here. We claim our heritage is Islam. No es Catholic. Yeah, that's it.
You know, Mary, yeah. Sister Mary, convivencia.
Yeah, so Mujed, talking to me on the phone, he's going to a conference on convivencia.
We're going to speak at Rice University.
Yeah, so he's on the phone with me, and I'm 1 hour describing convivencia, how people live together, Muslim, Jews, Christians, blah, blah. So I'm looking at his DNA yesterday, I'm like, oh my God, this is convivencia in action, you know what I mean? This is a journey of how Muslims got in contact with Jews, became in the process Catholic. I said, were you Catholic? Were you converted from Catholicism? I think you're just like a Catholic. All mixed in one person from DNA. Or you can, because you can't, I mean, how do you explain Damascus? How do you explain Saudi Arabia, Medina? How do you explain Berber concepts? How do you explain all of this? Wouldn't that all be like Muslim influenced? I don't want to say genetically you can be Muslim, but you're tracing Islam to a region, right? So this is that. So it's not about Islam being a racial thing, but you know how like now Muslims are being racially profiled?
Yes.
Like as a race?
Yes.
Islam is not a race, yeah? It's a faith that belongs to a lot of races. So Islam is anti-racism,
yes.
Right? It's anti-racism. But then to classify Islam as racist term, yeah? So I was looking at regions, but then I also adapted faith to regions. So the Berbers are the ones that Islamized, traveled to Spain, part of the convivencia, and then there was intermarriage somewhere, Sephardic married Muslim in the process, and then went to Colombia. I don't know why they went to Colombia, whether they escaped, whether they were forced, whether freedom of religion, what was going on, left, became Catholic, that's how his family found Islam.
So it was humbling to hear, you know.
Tell us what you were going to mention about the ancestors and the Latinos. I like for people to hear that. You mentioned that 2 years ago. It's something that I had mentioned to my husband himself. Then I heard it from you.
So that's how basically I started. I don't know if you guys remember how we started that this presentation will answer like a question and something that made me cry when I hear. So basically the documents, the anonymous documents that you kind of like are putting the docs together, and then
I talked to the documents. I'm like, what are you trying to tell me? Who are those people? Because I'm again about who the author is. I care about the writer. Who is writing and documenting and why? And are you writing this to your... Why is it landing in my hand? Like, what am I supposed to do with you? You must talk to the doctor. What do you want me to do? Just tell me what you want me to do. But, you know, I want people to know about this, for sure. The awareness is super important. But also, what is the relationship of the document to the people embracing Islam? You know, like, how... hard was it for the ancestors to cover and protect and keep on this message alive century after century after century after century? The persecution, I showed you what they did. This was not an easy journey. And then for them to go to the Muslim world and try to practice Islam and be labeled as not Muslim enough, not Muslim and not good enough, not this enough. So where do you go? Like, you have to adapt. So it's a process of assimilation. And Islam assimilates. That's the brilliance of the faith, is it has ability to assimilate to place, time, and cultures. But also there was a fiqh, there's a justification, a fatwa given to allow for this, all of this to happen. So two fatwas in 1501. One fatwa said, you can't stay in the land of the non-believers, you have to migrate and leave home. That was fatwa one. Mm-hmm. Fatwa one basically made it haram for you to stay behind. Mm-hmm. Fatwa two said, no, it's your home, you have to protect it. Yeah? And you practice tuqya, you hide your identity, it's halal. And there was a hope in the house. The hope was Constantinople fell right before Granada. And the Turks were moving east. Mehmed died a few kilometers from Rome. He wanted to take Constantinople and Roma, because there's a surah in the Quran called Rum. Ghulibat Rum. So they had the idea that Rome is Roma, not just Rome, but there's two Roman empires, Eastern Roman Empire, Western Roman Empire. They took the Eastern Roman Empire with Constantinople. There was Rome left. With Rome becoming Muslim, the entire Europe would be Muslim. I don't know if you can imagine Ottoman Empire taking on the entire European land.
I could.
Yeah? So with the Spanish Muslims hiding, the idea was, wait, we are coming. They told them this. The Ottoman Sultan said, just wait, hide, we're coming. The thing is, they never came. They never came. They stopped in Vienna. The Ottoman Turks and the battle stopped in Vienna. The famous battle was the end of hope in Muslim Spain. But it was too late, because they already had adapted and formed a way to practice Islam this way. So it's too late.
So I know that we have to respect the time. This presentation is supposed to end at 1 p.m. So actually we started a little bit longer, which is maybe 30 minutes late. So I don't know if you guys have questions or no, but I want to add three bonus that I remember that you didn't mention. So for you guys. Bonus one, no, it's for you. So the bonus one is the preservation of knowledge to the woman. And then we have the Al-Qarawiyya in Morocco. So maybe that's basically I'm asking questions for her to explain us. So the other one is the names. Why we find Jesus a lot in the Latino culture? Mm-hmm. And the third, I'll tell you after this.
So the first one is, I wanted to know who preserved the documents and how the documents circulated in the underground. Underground means in the secret society, yeah? So the way the documents, the men were under vigilance. Men were target, always searched. Are you have pistols? Do you have weapon? Do you have a sword? Do you have a paper on you? So the women were the tool of navigating the entire underground in Alanda. Like, this is after the fall of Spain. They go in the river and organize all the meetings. This week, the women seem not threatening to the regime. So when women are sitting and chit-chatting on a river and washing their clothes, they look like they're chit-chatting, right? And people look down on their chit-chat. But actually, women with their chit-chat were organizing which Jum'ah is done in which home, who's this week, how are we moving documents around. Women were the ones making the copies of the documents, circulating the documents in their skirts. They hide them. Nobody searched a woman's skirt. So this is how the women, and there's a story of a woman who cut her own tongue because she was going to be called to the Inquisition, so she wanted to show up without an ability. Torture me, kill me, do anything, I can't speak. I'm not going to give up the secret of my community. She cut her own tongue before she was taken in. So this is a famous story of the tongueless woman. walked into the they tried really hard. They knew she had, they knew she was the owner of the secret of the community. There's nothing they got out of her. It's the famous legend, the Hangless Maiden, the book written on this woman. Yeah. So this is one. Two was the names. We're talking about Christian world. Means, we remember how we talk colonizing Christian world, white male Christian. So they come from France, England, Germany, different countries. Well, there's no Jesus in English. There's no Jesus in French. There's no Jesus in Italian. But there's a billion Jesus in Spanish. Why? Like, show up somewhere and say, my name is Jesus. Like, who do you think you are? You know what I mean? Oh my God. Hold on. But Jesus is very common. And so is Maria, so is Jose, the three famous names in the Spanish. Well, that's just first name. So, question. Could it be that by using Jesus, you're protecting yourself and your identity from Inquisition? And then Jesus is very accepted in Islam. There's no problem naming Isa in Islam. There's no problem naming Isa. But ask a Christian, why don't you name your son Isa? An Arab is Christian. They don't. Because Isa is the God. You do not name your son after God. Right? This is God and Son of God. You can't, I mean, from the Christian perspective, you're not going to name yourself a God. Hey, hello, I'm God. You're not going to do that. Yeah? However, in the Spanish and Portuguese, it's a yes. Same thing with the last name. So this is just first name. Then look at last names. Leonardo da Vinci. One last name, Victor Hugo, Hugo, one last name, French, yeah? Michael Jackson. But take the Spanish one, or the Portuguese, you got the mom, you got the dad, and maybe a third one. Hernandez Gonzalez del Valle. Like, why? Why do I have mom, dad? Why are you mixing all my lineage together? Why am I getting all this salad bowl in my name? Yeah? So the mixing of genealogies, this is all research to be done. Like, I hope I'm recruiting researchers here. I hope I'm recruiting researchers to do the genealogy work and all that stuff, because this is all the work that needs to be done. Why do we have these first names? Why do we have these last names? Why? Explain it to me. I was talking to a professor who specializes in the Inquisition about this last week, and he was shocked. He's like, I never thought about it. It never hit me. It's so true. We're the only people who do that. Why? He's asking me why. I'm like, no, I want you to answer why. He's like, no, you tell me why. I'm like, no, you tell me why. He's like, oh my God, why are we doing this? Like, because it's genealogy, because the Jews care about male patriarchal even though you're Jew from your mom, you're still Ibn Banu Israel. You still carry the patriarchal line of, and for Muslim, you're not, I mean, yes, you are a son of your mom, you know, your mom makes du'a for you, your mom is important, but your genealogy is your dad. You don't carry your mom's last name. It's very hard for a Muslim to accept the mom's last name. What? The mom's last name? Why? You're not, I mean, you're an elite family of this male, right? It's very patriarchal. Yeah? And these two come from Ishaq, Ismail, and Yaqub. Yeah? Ismailites, Ismailitas, you saw it. And the genealogy of Prophet Muhammad, how you need to trace genealogy to the, yeah? And then the same thing with Banu Israel, you have to trace it back to Moses. Right? So the tracing of male, those two branches, Abrahamic faith and how they do genealogy, the two Abrahamic faiths, you know, Judaism and Islam, care about the patriarchal. Well, as the Christians too, but not the Spanish and Portuguese Christians, for a reason. So these are the questions to be answered. You have a third one?
Yeah, actually, coming up with the third one, I know it to pop up.
Oh, wow.
I'm sorry.
Okay.
Yeah. So, when I was, the first one, the easy one, or this is just a comment. When I was in Cordoba, when I went into the Great Mosque of Cordoba, this is how we all know this place, historical place. So when I checked the ticket, it didn't say the Great Mosque of Cordoba. So a couple years, 2-3 years ago, they changed the name to La Catedral de Cordoba. And people, Spaniards, they don't even know. So I started doing my own survey around, and I was like, just,
I asked the Spaniards,
I was like, so what do you think that they changed the name of the great mosque of Cordoba to La Catedral de Cordoba?
To the cathedral.
Cathedral de Cordoba, excuse my no. And they say, you know, this is part of our history. So even though if they change the name of of this place, we're gonna still call it La Gran Mezquita de Córdoba. So not only one, like many people. So they don't really care. So that's one thing. And then when I was in Granada, I learned about the Libros Plumbios.
I showed him the Libros Plumbios.
And again, she's gonna tell you about the Libros Plumbios. Do you guys know what is that?
No.
No? Nobody? This is very, very interesting. And again, I did my own research, my own like survey. So I was backpacking in Granada, subhanAllah. So I started asking the same thing, the Spaniards. So what do you know and what do you think about the Libros Plumbios? So the story is that when they found these books, she's gonna explain to you about these books. When they found these books, as soon as they found them in Granada, by the, ¿cómo se llama? So I'm not really know, but Yolanda, usted no, usted sabe? So I was in the Sacramonte.
Okay.
I was in the Sacramonte because I was visiting these caverns. And then they say that they found it by the monastery. Well, atrás, como atrás de la Alhambra, behind the Alhambra, you know, in this hill?
Yes.
Okay, so they found them over there. So when I asked them about that, it was very, very interesting. Because they said that when they found them, as soon as they got them, they sent them to the Vatican. So when they sent them to the Vatican, they came up with the research that those books are fake. So, and I asked the Spaniards, like, what do you think? So they say that they think that they are real. But when they, in the process of trasladaron los libros, so when they send the documents, they created other documents, or they basically came up with this story because there is no research or something in these regards. So that's the first one was a comment, the second one was this. So in the second one, you're gonna explain what is the Libros Plumbios, and the third one. So I brought Sheikh Hassan Khalil to Mexico. He was in my hometown in Monterrey. And when we were over there, I was waiting for my mom, and then I said, okay, I'm just gonna go to this museum. When I went to the museum, I found some documents in Arabic and some Qurans. So when I found these documents, I called Dr. Mariam, you cannot believe what I found. And she was like, Monterrey? Because if you look at the map and the story, it's like, okay, we believe that these kind of documents can be in South Mexico, but in the north, like where there is like a lot of, it's weird. She's gonna explain. So these documents in Monterrey, and I was like, yeah, you need to believe. So three pictures or something. Couple days after that, I think it was on Saturday, I think. Monday she was there. She took a flight from California, I don't know where you were coming from.
Mexico City.
Mexico City.
I dumped my research and I got on the plane.
And she was there and she met us. She met Hassan Khalil and myself. And then we met this doctor. Then it happens to be that I went to Spain and I met Dr. Mariam in Spain and this doctor from Monterrey, who is another academic who speaks like seven languages and is crazy, this guy. So over there, they introduced us with a guy that he happens to be giving a presentation in Monterrey. In one of the main and most important book of the fair is in Monterrey, Mexico City, and I think in Colombia or Argentina. So they brought this guy, and nobody cared about him. Nobody cared about him, but this doctor, he got so introduced, like so interested. So when we were in Spain, I think we were in Sevilla or Cordoba, and then this doctor, he was like, man, you guys need to meet this guy. So he called this guy, I'll take care of you, just travel. He was in Almeria, basically like in the south of Spain, near across the Mediterranean. So he took a train all the way to meet us. By the time we were leaving Sevilla, we were to Madrid. So he meet us, we met him in Madrid. His name is Ismael Deidara.
Haidara.
In Spanish, Deidara, right?
Yeah.
So his name is Ismael Haidara. And the interesting part is that he holds a whole library of thousands of manuscripts that left Granada before the burn, Toledo. So she's going to explain you this.
Yes. Okay, very nice. So two things, Libros Plumbios and Ismail Haidaran, okay? Ismail is a discovery, like Discovery Channel. Because he holds in Mali, in Tumbuktu, the library of Tumbuktu is the library of Toledo, before Granada fell. So the entire documents were transferred from Toledo to North Africa. They had this journey all around. And then his family were the holders to preserve it. So his background is Jews mixed with Muslims, mixed with Toledanos, Visigodos, Godos. I mean, he's really genealogy-wise, he's like authentic Spanish mixed with... But the ancestor that left with all these documents married a princess in Africa. Yeah, so that's how he got mixed with African, owns and holds it, and the Islamists are trying to burn the documents. So they left Spain because the books were going to get burned. They go to North Africa, West Africa, exile, yeah, to preserve the documents, and now the documents are under hunt. So he hid them, and he's in exile in Spain, but he got approved to bring all his documents, entire library, back to Toledo. Where? In the mosque. So he got the approval from Toledo regime, the city, to take a mosque, one of the old mosques never used. They're going to open it. And it's going to be the library that holds the Muslim documents that left Toledo prior to the fall of Granada.
So it's
a journey. He's doing a film. He's doing a documentary. And he published a book on how the documents left Spain. They can turn around the globe and they're going back home. So he's going, the books are going home.
And how we met this guy? Through a non-Muslim guy in Monterrey, in Mexico.
Allah.
So through a non-Muslim guy, he said,
You guys have to meet Ismail Haidar. You have to. He said, we're not leaving Spain without meeting this guy. We're going to make him fly. And he paid all his expenses to fly him, bring him, transportation, hotel. He paid everything for this guy to come and fly and be part of. Yeah.
And how he was traveling? With only one backpack. I was like, what is your luggage? There is no luggage, only one backpack and a notebook or whatever.
Yeah.
So this is a library that left Granada, and it took about 300-400 years. It's a process.
Look him up on his Facebook. He's a library of Tumbuktu, and look up Ismail Haidara. You have to follow what he writes and follow who he is.
Yeah.
He's I tried to see him in Spain last time I went. A very fragile state of health. He's much older and and I hope he finishes the project before.
So now this library is protected by the UNESCO.
UNESCO.
But it's hidden. So it's protected, but the thing is people cannot go over there to Mali. So it's protected in tribes.
It's like 4,000 manuscripts.
But they're not. Yes, the UNESCO said that they have it, you know, or it's protected. But they don't have the actual physical manuscript because they're hidden in tribes in Mali.
So we have a job of digitizing. Once they hit the archive,
yeah,
we need to digitize them, classify them, organize them, explain what they are, look at how this, it's all part of history of Islam and preservation of books.
And
then the Libros Plumbios.
And
okay.
Another thing came to my mind, SubhanAllah, I know we have to finish, but this non-Muslim doctor from Monterrey, he holds El Archivo de Granada. He's not Muslim and he holds the Archivo de Granada.
Oh, may Allah guide him. Yeah. He's very dear, like very nice person, very, very nice person, mashallah. And he holds the Archivo de Granada. He's like in his family, and well, it's very interesting. He's a collectionist of ancient documents from different places, but also in Arabic and about Islam. It's very interesting. Libros Plumbios. So the Libros Plumbios were in Granada after the fall. It's like about 100 years after. A priest has a dream. This is the story. That he dug a hole and found a Bible from first century. And he woke up in the morning and he told everybody, hey, I had a dream last night that we're going to find a Bible from first century. They dig. Hallelujah. We found it. But in that document, Plumbios is from lead. Plomo. So it's two like circles. And in those documents, Jesus is not a prophet. I mean, Jesus is not God, he's a prophet. And the salvation is through good deeds. He applies it in the church. Like, from now on, we're following this Bible. This is our... So basically, Christianizing Islam. I mean, it looks like it's Christianity, but it's really Islam, but under the cover of Christianity. Well, they follow this for like 100 years until the Pope discovers this disaster. Like, what's going on in Granada? It's like, oh, they're following Libros Plumbus. What is that? Bring them over. Bring them over, let's check them out and see what's going on. So they check out and they say, oh, this is falsified Bible. So story. But that's not what's surprising. What's surprising is the Libros Plumbus are present in Mexico City. In Seminario Conciliar, where they prepare the priests. So I go to 17 archives. One of them is where they prepare the priests. And I ask the priest, why do you guys have Libros Plumbus? Like, we don't know what that is. Explain it to us. Why do you have it in Mexico? How did you bring the, they're destroyed by the Pope? These are falsified Bibles, según, according to the Pope. And in Spain, they're not used anymore. In Granada, they're not used anymore. So why do you guys have it? What time history did you bring it in? So I was the one who opened their eyes that they have Libros Plumbus in Mexico City. They don't know what it is. And they were shocked. Like, why would we have a version of Christianity that denies the image of Jesus and the figure of Jesus and the whole concept of personification of God into the whole Jesus and the salvation and the blood and the sacrifice? This entire thing is denied in those Libros Plumbus. So, are they falsified, made up by Muslims? Well, Libros Plumbus tell me that Muslims infiltrated the church and became priests to protect their own people. The figure that will never be asked to come to the Inquisition, ever. You never, anybody will accuse you, friend, hatred, neighbor, no one will accuse the priest. So what if the priest is a crypto-Muslim himself? Because what if you have to join the very same apparatus that's torturing you in order to protect your own people? If that's your intention before Allah, who's to say it's haram? Who's to say it's wrong? Depends on your intention. But why would a priest create a version? This is the first, I was shocked. I said, okay, this is too wild that actually the priests are the ones fabricating Bibles to Islamize Christianity. That's pushing it too far. Too far. Because that means I have to question the image of the priest. Something I never, beyond my wild imagination, thought I could go there. So now I'm looking at every church. So now the church, the very same place that's persecuting, is the very same place that I'm searching. That's why I found it in Seminario Conciliar. When I told my sister in Mexico City, we're going to go to the Pontifice, whatever, she looked at me and said, what? We're not going to go to church, you know, a Christian place and find Muslim documents. I'm like, just trust me. Let's go. Trust me. They're hiding it in the very same place that nobody will search for it.
So we have possible priests that were Muslims that came over to Mexico.
Yes, and I'm questioning the Jesuit order.
Wow.
I'm questioning the Jesuit order. What if the Jesuits are the crypto Muslims?
Wow, that would be...
I'm actually following the Jesuits. Wow. That's my track. Jesuits are into education, they're into social work,
they're very tolerant,
and they're all about doing good deeds, they're all about educating people. And they care so much about it. What if the Jesuit order has Islamic flavor to it?
These are the people that came to Colombia.
The Jesuits?
Wow, they institutionalized so much good for the people. People came to know of the people from the Jesuit order to revive communities and bring about good.
So it's digging inside the very same place that we think cannot be dug into. It's a game. Put yourself in that time period and try to survive. It's a game. It's a survivor's game. And the mask that will never be put to question is the mask of the priest. Like, who's going to ask if the priest, hey, are you crypto-Jew, are you crypto-Muslim, are you this, are you that?
There'd be no suspicion.
Zero
suspicion. Never come up.
And then what if the Inquisition comes to the priest and says, hey, did Jalil confess on Sunday? Oh yeah, he's a very good Christian. He confesses every Sunday. Is someone going to question the testimony of the priest? No. Actually, I don't believe you. Let's put it into the question. No. Never.
Ever.
Ever. Full on hasana, like protection. This is how you protect the people.
Wow.
You get into the system, you infiltrate the church, and you become one of them. You wear the robe, you do the talk, you close the doors, you do whatever you want. Nobody knows when you close the doors of the church, what are you doing on the inside? And one of the things that make me wonder, or actually hold that hypothesis somewhere, is there are churches built after 1492 in the direction of Mecca with a mihrab behind the altar. These are not mosques transformed to churches. These are churches built with a mihrab in the direction of Mecca. So I have a question. Who knows about this except the very same people? I mean, I bet you the priest knows about this. And then if he closes the door and does his own congregation and protects from the Franciscanos, because let's put it into perspective. Franciscanos are the ones searching for Inquisition, money transfer, money laundering, whatever you want to call it, all that thing that I showed you. Franciscanos were it. The Dominicos. But what about the other religion? Why do we have so many? Ask the question, why do we have so many religious orders? What do they do? What each one does? Say, oh, the Jesuitas are the education end. The Carmelitas are the monje, the monjas, and they do the da da da. And so explain every religious order to me. And I said, and they're all Catholics? Yeah. But why are they divided? No, they're not divided. Oh, they're together? Yeah, they're together. But they're divided. No, they're not divided. Why are the different religious orders? Oh, they're made by specific people. The San Pedro did this, and I don't know. They start explaining the whole history to them.
They also have different target groups.
Yeah, different target groups.
That's what they were creating.
But the question is, would it be so interesting to create a religious order to protect your own people?
Yes.
Yeah, it makes sense.
It makes sense.
Why not? Why not? Create a religious order in which you embrace everybody, and you're part of the group.
The Vatican would deny it left and right.
The theory.
If you were to blow off the Jesuit, that the Jesuit order is exactly, was a Muslim order that was founded within the Catholicism.
I'm about to find out. I launched the theory and I...
It'll be a domino effect after that. The Vatican would be...
But wouldn't...
I
want to
go to the Vatican. The library I
want
to dig into, like my hands, really my gloves. Want to get into the archives there. That's my dream. That's my, but who knows? Maybe I get to open the archives in the Vatican.
Oh, they're hiding.
They're hiding it all. All there. All there. Everything you want to know is there.
Yep. Last year I was there and there is no such of pictures. Like in the Vatican, like there is El Tesoro. En El Tesoro del Papa, no puedes tomar fotos. You cannot take pictures.
Anyway, call me crazy, call me researcher, call me whatever. I don't think anything is given anymore. Nothing, what meets the eye is not what you see, is not what you get. Everything is off. And the documents showed me to do this kind of work, like to really think beyond outside the box.
Sister Mary, I know Erica was mentioning or asking about this specific, let's say, manuscript of when we first met in Mexico. You mentioned to me about a document or a manuscript that you read. It's anonymous, but it was it's like a dua, mm-hmm, of a person who's going through this oppression,
mm-hmm,
of withholding their deen. What did that say, and how do you connect that with people who are Latino or becoming Muslim?
Well, basically, that document is in Spain. And he starts by saying, he's apologizing, the author, I don't know if it's a he or she, she, apologizing, I'm so sorry, I don't know Arabic very well, I'm losing it, but I'm trying, okay, so sorry, so starts with an apology, and I'm trying to hold on to who I am, trying, I know I'm not good, should be better, but I'm trying. So it's like, it's just, it starts as an apology. The whole thing is just, I'm apologizing, you know? But trying to write it for the next generation. I just want my children to know that this is who we are. So I'm writing this for the next, writing it for the next generation. To kind of know this is who they are. I know I can't share it with them, yeah? Because they couldn't educate the children about Islamic identity until the age of 13. They had a policy, internal policy. you make the children run around the neighborhood eating pork, doing what they need to do. At the age of 13, you teach them no pork. Because if they go out and say, oh, mi familia no come puerco. Oh, really? Because you know how kids are. Yeah, kids, they blabber a thing, and then this is how your whole cover is taken off. Mm-hmm. So you don't tell the kids anything. Age 13, you bring a maestro, al faquilla, to the house. You start teaching them who they are, why they can't speak, why you start instilling a whole cover, acting, how do we do it. But that time, they're already Christian enough. They've gone to church, they've learned the basics, they have Christian names, nobody questions them. So by that time, kind of like easy for them to adopt the Muslim part of it. So they call this kind of work assimilation. Like Muslims have assimilated and became Catholics. That's the easy way of resting this topic. You know, we baptized them, they assimilated, they became Christians, good Christians, bad Christians, doesn't matter. They struggled a little bit because, you know, it was hard to walk out of Islam because they didn't want to be Catholics. But, you know, by second generation, third, fourth, they're all Catholic. Game over, it's done. That's it. But the Inquisition and that kind of work shows you to completely blow off this image that they all assimilated.
So these people had a difficulty practicing their deen, but in these documents, it almost seemed like they were almost trying to hold on to it and making dua that their descendants
would be.
So it's like a dua.
The question is, why did the document survive so we can read it today?
That's it.
Allah. Why is it not burned? Should be destroyed. They burned everything. Why is this thing alive? Why is it trying to tell us in contemporary times? Because every crime leaves traces. You can't wipe away crimes just like that. They leave traces behind. No matter how you systematically take away traces, something will come up and will make you find out. Justice. I think we are putting justice, we're giving justice to what happened by putting this topic to light. That's how. And then talk about how we look for, topics of victimization, such as Holocaust and this kind of topics, you know, like play victim forever. Let's talk about something that's real. We're not playing victims. This did happen. This is not, we're trying to be victims in history. This did happen. We just will not show it to the white Christian man who needs to see who's the terrorist. I have a question, who's the terrorist? The Spanish Inquisition, is that, or is that not the terrorist organization? Everybody's scared, everybody's afraid, everybody's hiding, everybody's in, what is that? Can't show your identity, can't speak up, can't say who you are, sneaking around the system, you know? What is that? So I ask questions.
And in the history books, by the way, for Latinos, from Spain and even in Latin American countries, there's a simple statement that kind of hides all of this. The Arab came to Spain with a sword and took Spain, you know, by the sword.
Mm-hmm.
And that's it.
As if it was a united Spain, which it was not.
Yeah.
You know?
It constructed fake Spain that we reconquered. Yes.
It's a constructed
history. It's a constructed history as though Spain was a homogeneous concept. As though Spain had the same religion, there's no oppression. When the Muslims arrived, the Christians were being oppressed. The Unitarian Christians, Arianism,
mm-hmm.
were being oppressed by the Roman Empire.
The Roman Visigoths.
Yeah.
Roman Visigoths.
So as though they were Catholics.
Mm-hmm.
that's the first assumption. As though they were united. That's the second assumption. As though there was one nation, like nation state.
Mm-hmm.
As though there was a nation state. And as though you're taking something back.
That's why they call it the Reconquista.
As though you're taking some, but it's also to delegitimize the Muslim presence. All part of that discourse of they're not legit, Moro. It's the same Moro concept. Moro is the outsider, same thing. Reconquista, that means we're just taking it back. It's mine and I'm just taking it. It was never yours. It doesn't matter if 800, 900, 1,000, it's never yours. You're the other, period.
You're the invader.
You're the invader, forever.
After the United States, in regards to following us on Facebook, the second country that follows the most is Spain. Because they don't have people teaching them Islam. You don't have like all the people of knowledge. MashaAllah, here in Dallas, you have people of knowledge teaching their kids sometimes can't have Islamic school. The professors at the universities cannot be Muslim who are teaching Islam. So these people are wanting to connect, especially the Muslims, and when they see something online with digital media now, and they see it coming from the United States, I mean, this information doesn't exist.
They're more at home with this topic because, you know, being Spanish and refinding Islam, I mean, you're home. You haven't done any migration, going around the world, doing that work. You're the one who stayed home and struggled. You're not the one who migrated and tried to fit in somewhere else. You're the one who stayed home and struggled. So finding Islam within that context, or the awareness, imagine raising that awareness within the Spanish society to question your own identity. Question, how Christian are you? Really. Do your DNA test, figure out who you are. Yeah. Thank you so much.
So Allah has blessed, but perhaps Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is censoring the dua of these guys in times of oppression with the Latinos. Perhaps we are the result of their dua. Allah has blessed.
They could be Allah's long lost ancestors. They should be ours. That we don't know, we just find. Sister Miriam said that with my DNA when she was looking at it yesterday. From ancestor DNA, she saw all of this, right? And we do look for something, and we don't know what we're looking for. So when you give a space available for people to go there, you'll find that they'll come. In Houston, after 2 years after opening up the center, we have about 115 people who have embraced Islam. And this is the narrative that we utilize. It is not a narrative of religiosity. It is a narrative of overturning some stones and figuring out who you are as a human being and where you come from.
It's your lineage. It's your birthright.
So there are salams. When I was recording over there are salams a lot from Mexico, even like the far away from Singapore. So people are watching us right now from Singapore. Subhanak Allahumma wa bihamdihi wa ashhadu la ilaha illa ant astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to purify our intentions, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us for any shortcomings and to protect us and to show us what's the truth and to keep us always in the right path. And I just wanted to basically finalize with a more formal dua from Imam Shadanim. I don't know if you mind. One of the first times when I met him, he said, "I believe that the future of Islam." I won't forget this. He was like, "I believe that the future of Islam is among the converts, especially within the Latinos and the black people."
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Allahumma rabbana laka alhamdu hamdan kathiran tayyiban mubarakan fihi. Subhanaka rabbana la nuhsi thana'an alayk. Anta kama athnayta ala nafsik. ربنا صل وسلم وبارك وزد على نبينا المصطفى يا الله يا رب العالمين. You are the guide and we are your slaves and servants. يا الله, we ask you رب العالمين, as you have guided us, that you bless us to remain guided and to be a source of guidance for others. يا الله, we ask you رب العالمين for every heart and soul that is searching for you and every nook and cranny on this earth. يا الله, that you guide them to you. Ya Allah, help us to show the beauty of this lifestyle of our religion of Al-Islam so that we can be good ambassadors for you. Ya Allah, we ask you, Rabbil Alameen, that you bless the work of what our brothers and sisters of what we see here today with our sister Dr. Maryam, Ya Rabbil Alameen. Ya Allah, we ask you that you guide her and that you grant her insight and wisdom in all that she's doing of research, and that she comes to answers that are going to enlighten the Latino world and humanity as a whole. Ya Allah, we ask you that you put the financial support and backing for this important research that is taking place. Ya Allah, we ask you, Rabbil Alameen, as converts and as Muslims as a whole, Ya Allah, that we do not allow our nationalistic and our ethnic identities to divide us. Ya Allah, that you do not allow anything of these worldly things to enter our hearts and to divide us. Ya Allah, we ask you, Rabbil Alameen, that you truly bless our hearts to love each other for your sake and cause. Ya Allah, that we live as the best of Muslims, that we die as the best of Muslims, and that we are resurrected on that day as the best of Muslims. Allahumma ameen. Ya salli Allahumma sallim wa barak ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin.
En la página. La página, sí. En la página, en la página.
Yes, it has a lot to do with the travel 100,000 years before Columbus.
Yeah, yeah. There's so much history. Yeah. So much history. So much history.
Yeah,
but
that's the
case. It's like his genealogy. Well, cortan. Okay.